Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this brand new episode of the podcast called The Dictionary with me, your host, Spencer. It is a beautiful day here in the Chicago area. It is going to get to a warm temperature, unseasonably warm for what is today? What is today? It's early March, March 5th. It's going to get up to like 65 where I am. So after I record a few episodes, I think I'm going to go for an easy jog and try and get back into the habit of being healthier exercise-wise. Okay, let's talk about these words. The first one is the second form of cream, C-R-E-A-M, verb from 1596. Let's see, we are starting with intransitive. Yes, we are. One, to form cream or a surface layer like the cream on standing milk. So to form cream or the layer of something on something that is like cream. I'm not a big fan of when something like milk or something else has a layer on top of it. That's just a little gross to me. Okay, number two, to break into or cause something to break into a creamy froth. To break into or cause something to break into a creamy froth. Also, to move like froth. Now I wanna make up a dance that is moving like froth. How would your body move like froth? I don't know. I'll figure it out later. Okay, now we have transitive 1A. It is the 1C definition for the word skim. And I think I just realized that skim milk is called skim milk because you have skimmed off much of the fat, the cream. You've taken it off, skimmed it away, so it's called skim milk. It's a kind of an odd name when you think about it that way. Shouldn't it be something else? I don't know. Maybe I think other people call it other things. 1B. To remove from an aggregate. And the thing that you are removing is something choice. To remove something choice from an aggregate. As in, she has creamed off her favorite stories from her earlier books. And that is from the Times Literary Supplement. But what is... So she took away her favorite stories... So she has written books, but then she took away her favorite ones. Why? Where did she put them? Did she make another collection of those? Or did she say, no, sorry, my favorite ones, you can't read them anymore? Or maybe these aren't ones that she wrote. Maybe these are the ones that she's read. I don't know the context, but I think you understand it now. Number two, to furnish, prepare, or treat with cream, also to dress with a cream sauce. That's talking about food. 3A, to beat into a creamy froth. Going to beat it something sense. Bleh, I didn't like that. My dance is going to be... I'm going to be put into a creep. This is a terrible route we're going down. We're going to move on to 3B. To work or blend to the consistency of cream, as in cream, butter, and sugar together. Mix them so good that they become creamy. 3C. To cause to form a surface layer of or like cream. 4A. To defeat decisively, as in, was creamed in the first round. It's like they were beaten to a pulp, they were beaten to a cream. That is probably why that word is that word in this context. 4B, the synonym is wreck, W-R-E-C-K, like wreck it, Ralph, as in, creamed the car on the turnpike. How often do people use this? I feel like maybe I'd say I got creamed if I was in an accident, but yeah, I don't know if I've heard this in terms of a car wreck. 4C, to hit with force, And the synonym is smash, as in the quarterback got creamed by the pass rush. Yeah, again, they were just hit so hard, they turned into cream. There's no etymology for this because we dealt with that a little bit in the last one. So, sound effect is shush. Next word, cream cheese. Two words. Noun from 1583. A mild, soft, unripened cheese made from whole sweet milk enriched with cream. So, milk and cream turns into this cheese that they don't let ripen. And it's pretty tasty. I haven't had, let's see, I've had some vegan cream cheeses over the years, but not a lot, so it's been a while. But yeah, just there's nothing better than like bagel and cream cheese. Okay, shush. Next word is cream cups. It's just one word, cream cups. Noun from 1888. It is a California annual of the poppy family. And the species name or scientific name is Platystemon californicus. It grows, it's an annual, so it is, I always get this mixed up. Is a perennial one that comes back every year, but an annual you have to replant every year? Plant people, tell me, let me know. But it's an annual of the poppy family. Shush. Next is creamer. Noun from 1858. One, a small vessel for serving cream. Oh, can I please have the creamer because it has the cream that I want to put in the thing, the coffee? Two, a non-dairy product used as a substitute for cream, as in coffee. So you can put cream in your coffee, or you can get this non-dairy version, which honestly probably still has some milk in it if you look at the ingredients. And that's just called a creamer to cream the coffee and maybe your tea if you like that. Shush! Next word is creamery. So you can say it with two syllables or three syllables, creamery or creamery. I prefer the three-syllable version, creamery. Noun from 1872. An establishment where butter and cheese are made or where milk and cream are prepared or sold. It's where they deal with cream of various forms. Shush! Next is cream of tartar. And this is three words I like to say just because that's how it's spelled. Tartar. Cream of tartar. But normally I would just say cream of tartar. 1662, I would assume it's a noun, but it doesn't say. It is a white crystalline salt, C4H5KO6, used especially in baking powder and in certain treatments of metals. I feel like I've heard of this before and always thought it was just a cream thing for food, but based on this definition, I'm not so sure about that. It's in, I mean, you put it in foods because it's used in baking powder, but also metals? This is a very fascinating crystalline salt. Next word, shush. Cream puff, two words, noun from 1880, one, a round shell of light pastry filled with whipped cream or a cream filling. I probably have had a cream puff before. I don't remember. It's been a long, long time, but it sounds pretty good. Two, an ineffectual person. Such a cream puff. It's just because I think this cream puff dessert, it's got this hard-ish shell, but it's actually very fragile. So it doesn't take a lot of effort to just, you know, pop it, break it, I think. If you're talking about a person and they're just not very effectual in any way, they can break their outer shell, metaphorically speaking, they are a cream puff. Three, something trifling, inconsiderable, or easily dealt with. It's just so easy. Four, a usually used motor vehicle that is in especially good condition. Why would you call that a cream puff? Sure there are reasons. Next word. Shush. Cream soda, two words, noun from 1854. A carbonated soft drink flavored with vanilla. I really like this stuff. I like the vanilla. I like root beer. Those go hand in hand. They're sort of in the same world of sweet, non-alcoholic, carbonated beverages. Then you get in the whole other world of orange soda and stuff. But I don't know. Root beer and cream soda are like, they're like salt and pepper. I don't think I've ever mixed them together. That would be good. You got to find a good ratio. Is it 50-50? Is it 66-33, 75-25? How do we want to mix them together? Then you can put some ice cream in there. Mm-hmm. Next word. Shush. Creamware. One word, noun from 1780. Earthenware having a cream-colored glaze. That's why it's creamware. Next. Shush. Creamy. Adjective from 1618. One, containing cream. It's very obvious. Two, resembling cream, as in color, texture, or taste, as in a creamy consistency. Depending on what it is, if it's, let's talk about food. If depending on the food that it has a creamy consistency, it might be great and perfect, and it might be weird. Like, you don't want your burger to be creamy. You don't want your vegetables or fruits necessarily to be creamy, but maybe you want your cream cheese to be creamy. We have a couple more examples for this second definition. Creamy skin, also a creamy voice. I would so love to have a creamy voice, but I'm not so sure I do. How do we make my voice more creamy? Ahoy, hoy. Creamily is an adverb, and creaminess is a noun. A lot of these have not had etymology to speak of. Just looking back, maybe I missed something. No, I don't think I did. Okay, next word. No more cream. Shush. It is crease. C-R-E-A-S-E. First form, noun from 1578. One, a line, mark, or ridge made by or as if by folding a pliable substance. Your shirt, if you fold it and it gets funky, if something's folded over, it's going to create a crease. And then maybe you need to let it hang. You got to steam it to get the creases out. I have to do that often if I want to look fairly presentable to the world. Number two, a specially marked area in various sports, especially an area surrounding or in front of a goal, like in the games lacrosse or hockey. And of course, I don't play these games, so I don't know. I didn't realize there was a place called the crease. What does it do? It's in front of the goal. Is it the box where the goalie has to stay in? Is that the crease? Is there a different line that's the crease? Nobody knows. Creaseless. That is an adjective. The etymology basically says this is from Middle English cresta, C-R-E-S-T-E, which means the just crest. Crest. Crest and crease. Shush. Next word is the second form of crease. This is the verb form from 1588. One, to make a crease in or on. And the synonym is the word wrinkle, as in a smile creased her face. I am getting wrinkles gradually. By the end of this podcast, I will definitely have some more wrinkles all over the face because it's going to take so many years to finish this up. Number two, to wound slightly, especially by grazing. No. It's not wound. It's wound. To wound slightly, especially by grazing, as in creased by a bullet. So if the bullet just grazed your arm and you got injured by it, just very slightly relative to normal bullet wounds, you've been creased by it because it created a crease on your arm. Those were all transitive. Now we have one intransitive, to become creased. My face is slowly becoming creased. If I didn't move it so much, it would become creased much more slowly. If I didn't emote, if I didn't smile or show emotion on my face, then I wouldn't have so many creases and wrinkles. Creaser, that is a noun. Okay, we have one more word, two forms. Shoosh? It is the word create. C-R-E-A-T-E. First form. Let's see. Oh, you can emphasize either syllable. Create or create. I don't really like that second one. I prefer the first one. This is a verb from the 14th century, starting with transitive. One, to bring into existence, as in, God created the heaven and the earth. And you can, it's just an example of how you could use it in a sentence. You can take it or leave it, whatever, but that is from the Bible, Genesis 1:1, and then it says AV, which I don't know what that means. 2A, to invest with a new form, office, or rank, as in, was created a lieutenant. It's a weird way to word that sentence, but fine. Was created a lieutenant. 2B, to produce or bring about by a course of action or behavior, as in, her arrival created a terrible fuss. Oh, why? Why would her arrival create a fuss? Was she not expected? She wasn't invited to the party, maybe, but then she showed up, and then everybody fussed about it. Also as in, create new jobs. 3, the synonyms are cause and occasion, as in, famine creates high food prices. Famines, that's not a fun thing to go through, and a lot of people throughout the world are dealing with that. 4a, to produce through imaginative skill, as in, create a painting. 4b, the synonym is design, as in, creates dresses. Okay, now we have intransitive. 1, to make or bring into existence something new. 2, to set up a scoring opportunity in basketball, as in, create off the dribble. You were dribbling, and then you set up a scoring opportunity, so then you created a score from your dribble, I guess. Okay. Okay, what does the etymology have to say? From the Latin verb creare, or creare, akin to the... It doesn't say what that means, but it is akin to the Latin verb crescere, which means to grow. And there's more at the word crescent. Yeah, it makes sense. If you're creating something, it's growing, it has to start small, little... Whatever, it has to start from a germ, a seed, and then grow into something else. And that literally could be a plant, a person, a piece of artwork, whatever. Okay, we have one more word officially. Shush! It is the second form of create, adjective from the 15th century. It is archaic, and the synonym is created, with a D at the end. Okay, so the words were cream, cream cheese, cream cups, creamer, creamery, cream of tartar, cream puff, cream soda, creamware, sorry, creamy, crease, crease, create, create. Well, I need to look ahead to tomorrow's episode because I'm kind of tempted to maybe pick create, but maybe like we've got some other good ones in tomorrow's episode that are sort of like that. So maybe I'll pick one of those. Let's see, is there anything else that's jumping out at me? I will pick cream soda as the word of the episode. I would like some cream soda in my glass. It's carbonated and vanilla flavored. I don't know. I'm just trying to do something different with these songs. I hope that you are enjoying this podcast, and please keep on listening and share it and all that good stuff. And hey, we'll be back tomorrow or mere seconds from now with another episode. Is that all I got to say? We just finished last night The Righteous Gemstones, very adult show on HBO, but so silly and funny. We watched a couple videos of bloopers, but honestly, there were not enough of them. I need more bloopers from that show because all those people are so silly and funny. Yeah. Okay. That's it. Thank you. Oh, I think today is tax day. The day that this is coming out in 2022, it is tax day. So I hope you finish your taxes before the end of today. Good luck. I hope you get some money back. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to this podcast called The Dictionary. I am reading this book in short sections, and my thoughts come out, and sometimes they get flummoxed. Sometimes they're not. Sometimes it's just all the things. And I hope it's semi-entertaining for you, and I hope it's also more so, I hope it's educational for you. Okay. The first word in this episode is creatine. Yeah, or you can just say creatine. C-R-E-A-T-I-N-E. Noun from 1840. A white crystalline nitrogenous substance. Nitrogenous is like nitrogen, nitrogenous. C4H9N3O2. Found especially in the muscles of vertebrates, either free or as phosphocreatine. Creatine, is that the word? Creatine. But we have more. We have also a synthetic, usually hydrated form of creatine, taken especially as a dietary supplement. Okay. It's found in the muscles of vertebrates, and it is a white crystalline nitrogenous substance. And then, yeah, people take it, I guess, as a dietary supplement. I don't know exactly what it's supposed to do. Hydrated form. That means there's water in it. I've heard of it. I've definitely heard of it, but that's it. That's all I got. The etymology. It is from the French, creatine, from Greek, creat with a K, or creas, which means flesh. So yeah, it's, you know, it's in the muscles. That's the flesh of a vertebrate. And there's more at the word raw, R-A-W. And what is my sound effect? I just had one. It was like a I don't know. Next word is creatine kinase. Creatine kinase. Two words. The second form is K-I-N-A-S-E. Noun from 1964. Any of three isoenzymes found especially in vertebrate, skeletal, and myocardial muscle that catalyze the transfer of a high-energy phosphate group from phosphocreatine to ADP with the formation of ATP and creatine. And I don't know what I just read. Any of three isoenzymes found in vertebrate skeletal, so it's more about in the vertebrates, the skeleton, and the muscles, and they do some scientific-y, chemical-y stuff. Next word is creatine phosphate. Second word is P-H-O-S-P-H-A-T-E. Noun from 1945, and the synonym is just phosphocreatine. All one word. I don't know if that's a very good sound effect. It's going to hurt my throat, maybe. I'll try and adjust it. Okay, the next word is creatinine. So we added a syllable. We had creatine, and this is creatinine. C-R-E-A-T-I-N-I-N-E. Yeah. Or you could also just say creatinine. Noun from 1851, a white crystalline strongly basic compound, C4H7N3O, formed from creatine and found especially in muscle, blood, and urine. So it is similar to creatine. It is formed from creatine. It's found in other places of the body in addition to the muscles. So that is that. The etymology says it's just from the Greek creatin, which is creatine. So, but because it's a different chemical compound situation, you have to add the new letters in the name. Creatinine instead of creatine. It's not confusing at all. Next word is creation. Creation, noun from the 14th century. One, the act of creating, especially the act of bringing the world into ordered existence. Huh, there's a lot in that statement. Many levels. The act of bringing the world into ordered existence is creation. I'm not so sure how I feel about that. Number two, the act of making, inventing, or producing. As, 2A, the act of investing with a new rank or office. 2B, the first representation of a dramatic role. They have created that dramatic role. It is a creation. 3, something that is created. As, 3A, the synonym is the word world. I almost said the synonym is the world. Okay. 3B, creatures singly or in aggregate. I think that's singly, like a single creature, or an aggregate, a whole group of them. Creation. You can probably see where this is heading. 3C, an original work of art. Say, it's your creation. I want to make more creations. I have lots of creations in my brain that I haven't been able to make. Maybe someday. 3D, a new, usually striking article of clothing. Ooh. If you're a fashion designer and you make something new and striking, it's your creation. There is no etymology. So, moving on to creationism. This is in the book, creationism. Now, I may lose some listeners, or maybe not. I don't know, but we have to talk about it. Noun from 1880, a doctrine or theory holding that matter, the various forms of life, and the world were created by God out of nothing, and usually in the way described in Genesis. And then it says to compare to the opposite word, the 4B definition for the word evolution. Creationist is a noun or an adjective, and also somebody who I am not. I am not a creationist because I think that this is, to be perfectly honest, absolutely bonkers, and I don't understand how people can think that this is true. People believe it. People teach it in schools, and I just have a big, big problem with that because science is the thing. As Ricky Gervais has said, and I may have said this before, I don't care, I'm going to say it again, if you destroyed all the books in the world, all the books, and in 1,000 years, I should back up. If you destroyed all the books, you got religious books and you have scientific books, all of the scientific books would be recreated in like 1,000 years or so, because that it's just facts. It's science. And the religious books are subjective, and it's opinions. It's not facts. So I'm sorry. I just have a big problem if anything is the opposite of science. It goes against science. I should say that. That's a whole big conversation. We're not going to dwell on that anymore. If you are a creationist and you enjoy this podcast, I surely do appreciate that, and I will not be offended if you stop listening, because there's a whole lot of other good stuff in here to learn about. I hope that my personal opinions do not offend you, but if they do, sorry. I hope you have a good day. Okay, next word, relatedly, it is creation science. It's an interesting to put those two words together in this context. Noun from 1979. The synonym is creationism, which is what we just read, but then also scientific evidence or arguments put forth in support of creationism. I have a real hard time believing that there is scientific evidence for creationism. I think it is much more about the arguments than the scientific evidence. I understand that this book has to be right down the middle of the world, the road politically, and you got to put all the stuff out there. That's fine. But I hope that the creators of this book are not leaning in one direction or another. Because, you know, back in the day, we had a lot of words that I was questioning why there were so many of them. It is what it is. Whatever. Yeah, creation science. Okay. Next word is creative. You can say creative, emphasize the A, or you can say creative or creative. You have to emphasize the first one or the second one. First form, adjective from 1678. One, marked by the ability or power to create. And then also given to creating, as in the creative impulse. I get the creative impulse a lot, but then it just stops right there, and I don't usually get to go further than that. This is a very, very complicated topic. Two, having the quality of something created rather than imitated. The synonym is imaginative, as in the creative arts. I want that to be the creative farts. Three, managed so as to get around legal or conventional limits, as in creative financing. Also, deceptively arranged so as to conceal or defraud, as in creative accounting. Creatively is an adverb, and creativeness is a noun. Second form of creative, noun from 1962. One who is creative, especially one involved in the creation of advertisements. I always kind of find it silly or weird or something when people say, I am a creative. I don't know, this gets into a whole other thing that's just my own personal weirdness. But I don't know. It's like you're saying, I am very creative. But then I guess I sort of have issues with that. But then I think, well, you know, all you're doing is saying, that I am, you're just recognizing the fact that you are more of a creative person who wants to create and write and draw and whatever, opposed to someone who is possibly much more into, say, numbers and finances. You know, not that they can't be creative. It's just in that sort of advertising, marketing world, media, whatever, they tend to be just lumped into two or more different worlds. So, you know, a creative is the one who's maybe, yeah, writing the thing or editing the thing or whatever. And then the other people who are not quote-unquote creatives are dealing with maybe the finances or the logistics or something. Sometimes it's the same person. I feel like I straddle both worlds a lot. Number two, creative activity or the material produced by it, especially in advertising. Next word is, okay, this is going to be interesting, creative evolution. Two words, noun from 1909. Evolution, that is a creative product of a vital force rather than a spontaneous process explicable in terms of scientific laws. And it says compare to emergent evolution, which I have to assume is just a different kind of evolution. But this definition didn't really help me. Do I have to read it again? Evolution, that is a creative product of a vital force rather than a spontaneous process. Okay, explicable in terms of scientific laws. So what I think it's saying is that normally evolution happens very slowly, very natural process, but there is this creative evolution that is from a vital force. So maybe something very big happened to a community, a habitat, and it forced them to evolve much more quickly, maybe, than they would have otherwise. Otherwise? There's no D at the end of that. Otherwise. I don't know. I could be wrong about that. That's just sort of what I'm gathering from this. I do find the topic of evolution incredibly fascinating, so I should learn more about this. Maybe I'll put a thing in the show notes to give us all more information. Yeah. I think that because humans are having such a huge effect on the world and so quickly, like climate change, that the creatures of the world can't evolve quickly enough. I don't know. We can obviously talk more about that when we get to the E's, to evolution. We can have a whole conversation. I should probably try and find somebody who knows more about evolution to be a guest on that episode. I should start trying now. Okay, let's move on. Next word is creativity. Creativity. I feel like there should be a, instead of a nativity scene, it should be a creativity scene. And but what would you, you'd have to get creative. Maybe it's like, you know, the cows in Chicago where everybody gets the same cow, but then they can like paint it or change it in whatever way they want. Maybe different people can get a nativity scene or the basics of a nativity scene, but then they can change it and create it in whatever the way they want. I don't know. I think that would be kind of fun. Noun from 1875. One, the quality of being creative. Two, the ability to create. We all have the ability to create, but sometimes people have a harder time than other people, or they just, I don't know, they just want to do other things. Creativity. I think about this a lot. I do. Next word. Creator. Noun from the 13th century. One that creates, usually by bringing something new or original into being. Especially, here we go. This is, yep, that's a thing. Especially the number one definition for the word God, G-O-D. Yes, a lot of people say that creator, that's not how the phrase goes. A lot of people say that God is the creator. That is their opinion. But I usually like to think of creator as the main part of the definition, which is just one who is creating a thing. I am a creator because I am creating this podcast and often, you know, other silly videos, which you can go find on my YouTube channel, which is, of course, the links are in the show notes. Yeah, I don't know why I like to do that, but I like to do that, and I don't do it as much as I would like, as I have said many times, so we don't need to say it again, but we just did. So let's move on to creature. Noun from the 14th century. 1. Something created either animate or inanimate, as 1a, a lower animal, especially a farm animal. I don't know what the proper definition is for the word lower in this context, a lower animal. I don't think that they are lower than anything else, especially farm animals. They are just the same as all the other animals. So why do we need to call them lower? I think it's because of brain comprehension. Primates like us and chimps and gorillas and bonobos and orangutans and all those, we have a different way that our brain can comprehend the world than something like a cow or even a cat or a dog. But are a cat and a dog lower animals, or are farm animals? But pigs are farm animals, and they're just as smart as dogs, if not smarter. So what's with all these words, lower, higher animal? I don't know. 1b, a human being. 1c, a being of anomalous or uncertain, I lost my place, a being of anomalous or uncertain aspect or nature, as in creatures of fantasy. How many creatures of fantasy can I think of? Well, we've got trolls and goblins and fairies and unicorns. And there's so many others. Ogres. Okay, that's totally fine for this. Number 2, one that is the servile dependent or tool of another. And the synonym is instrument. A creature is an instrument. But it's a... So is it a living thing? Creatural. I don't think I've ever heard this word before. Creatural. There's an A-L at the end. That is an adjective. Creaturehood is a noun. Creatureliness. Creatureliness is a noun. And creaturely is an adjective. Those are some fun words there. Okay, etymology. There's nothing really. It's just this word and this word, but they don't say what they mean, so I don't know. Okay, I think we have one more for this episode. I don't even know what this sound effect is anymore. Is it a creature's sound? Creature comfort. 2 words. Noun from 1652. Something that gives bodily comfort. And the examples of those things would be food, warmth, or special accommodations. I have to give a shout out to the, it started off as just a short, a 5 or 10 minute animated, stop motion animated short by Nick Park, the guy who is behind Wallace and Gromit and Aardman Animations. And they did turn it into a TV series, I think, of short episodes, multiple seasons. But anyway, that first one, it's okay. So what they did was they interviewed people all across England. They either went to a zoo and interviewed them there about the animals, or they interviewed them about their living conditions, their own living conditions. These are all humans that they interviewed, obviously. And then they edited those interviews together, just audio, and then they created animated scenes to that audio. And they were all animals, mostly in zoos. I think there might have been maybe a couple of circus animals or something. But anyway, you got to go see it. You can find it. I'm sure it's on YouTube. I'll find a link. I might even I might even put a little audio clip in here, because it's just so silly. And when you know the story behind it, when you know that these are real people talking about either their own living conditions or the animals' living conditions and their lives, in a zoo or something. I don't know. I just, there's a whole new appreciation for that whole short. I think it was even Academy Award nominated or winning, one of those two. It's very good. Creature Comforts is what it's called. I don't even know if I said that.
I'd like to live somewhere a bit hotter. I don't like getting rained on, and I don't like being cold. And I find that here I often get rained on, and I'm often cold.
Okay, so the words in this episode were creatine, creatine kinase, creatine phosphate, creatinine, creation, creationism, creation science, creative, creative, creative evolution, creativity, creator, creature, creature comfort. Well, I'm going to pick either creative or creativity. Which one do you think I should pick? Let's see. Creative, creativity. They're similar and different. I guess maybe I'll just pick creative as the word of the episode. I don't know. I don't, for whatever reason, in my genes and in the people who I was around when I was growing up, that is just the world that I fell into, the creative world. But at the same time, I very much genetically have an appreciation for the not creative things, the, you know, something like data entry or numbers, spreadsheets, that kind of stuff. Never was good at English, so like English classes, reading and writing was, you know, I could do it fine, but never was good at as other people, you know, abstract thinking, could not really do that. So I've always struggled between those two sides of my personality, and I'm really trying to get more into the creative world. Creative, yeah, I don't know. Well, how do we see? This is why I do this podcast, and this is why I force myself to do these songs. Because it's like a muscle. You keep on doing these creative things, you get better at them. Although, I'm pretty sure these songs are getting worse and worse. That's just my own opinion. You can tell me what you think. Creative. I'm trying to be creative. Let's make things and be creative. I just want to be myself and be creative in my life. And get paid for it. Okay. That is it for this episode. At the end of yesterday's episode, I mentioned that we just finished watching The Righteous Gemstones. I think we're going to watch the one season so far of The After Party, which I have been avoiding because I just wanted to binge it when it finished, which it just finished yesterday at the time of recording. So I'm very excited about that. I love all the people in the show. I love the creators of the show. And let's see what it's all about. They are very creative. Let me tell you what. Okay, long episode. Sorry about that. Had a lot to say. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary, the podcast where I read the dictionary and I tell you what I think about the things that I read. It could be the definitions, how the word sounds, the etymology, the examples, and other stuff. If you would be so kind as to rate and review this podcast on, you know, Apple Podcasts or Spotify or something else, you know that would make me just feel, oh, my heart would grow so much if you did that. I want to read the reviews. I will read your review in an episode if you write one. When I read it, the next episode I record, I will read it out loud to the people. I will say your name if you want me to. It might be your real name. It might be your username. Whatever name you choose, that's the one I will use. Hey, that rhymed. You can call the Google voice number. It is in the show notes, so it should be easy to find. Call, leave a voicemail, tell me what you think about something that you heard. You can also tell me what you think about upcoming words. You know, hopefully it's far enough in the future that I will be able to edit it in an episode before I air it, so you might want to look ahead. But anything, literally anything from, say, like D through Z, leave me a voicemail and And then maybe I'll put it in an episode. What else? Instagram and Twitter, those are at dictionarypod. Gmail email is dictionarypod@gmail.com and all of that good stuff. Okay, let us read this last section of page 293. The first word is creche or creche. Creche or creche? C-R-E-C-H-E. Noun from 1792. One, a representation of the nativity scene. Oh, and that's kind of funny that that has come up because we just had yesterday creativity, and I mentioned a nativity scene. So creche is a representation of the nativity scene. It could be whatever representation you want it to be. Wait, there's a thing, whatever representation you want it to be of the nativity. Number two, the synonym is day nursery. Three, a foundling hospital. What is a foundling hospital? Four, a group of young animals gathered in one place for care and protection, usually by one or more adults. And examples of these young animals would be penguins or bats. I know that the penguins, when the winter is very bad, they all huddle together and they keep the young in the center, I believe. They all huddle together for warmth and, you know, the adults are taking care of the babies. Maybe that would be called a creche or a creche. I have not heard of this. Let's see. It is from Old French, creche, which means manger or crib, of Germanic origin, akin to the Old High German krippa, which means manger, and there is more at the word crib. And I'm realizing that my microphone feels loud, so I'll just turn it down in post. Oh boy, it's time for a sound effect. It's going to be... ba-ding! Okay, next word, cred. Noun from 1981. This synonym is credibility, which we will be getting to later this episode, but we have specifically the ability to gain acceptance as a member of a particular group or class, as in, used his new street cred to develop contacts. To develop contacts. That is a quote from Dale Keeger. No clue who they were talking about, who he was talking about. His new street cred. Some person got some new street cred and he was trying to develop contacts. Okay, that's it for cred. Next word, ba-ding. It's credence. Credence. Noun from the 14th century, 1A. Mental acceptance as true or real, as in, give credence to gossip. What? So if you are if you're passing along gossip, does that mean that you are giving credence to it? You think it is true, so you are passing it off as true? I guess so. I guess it doesn't have to be true. It's just the acceptance as true or real. 1B, it is the number one definition for the word credibility, as in, lends credence to the theory. And we will see what that number one definition is soon. Let's see, number two, the synonym is credentials. We will also get to that shortly. And this one is used in the phrase letters of credence. So if we replace it with credentials, it is letters of credentials. Number three, a Renaissance sideboard used chiefly for valuable plate. A Renaissance sideboard used chiefly for valuable plate. Not entirely sure what that is talking about. Four, a small table where the bread and wine rest before consecration. And a synonym for everything is the word belief. So, yeah, this seems like it has to do with truth. Truth or believing that something is true. So, what does the etymology actually say? It is from the Latin verb credere, which means to believe or trust. And there's more at the word creed, which I'm guessing that's going to be in tomorrow's episode. No, the day after that, 2 days from now. Or 2 episodes from now, because maybe these days have already passed for you. All right. So that was Credence, the Credence Clearwater Revival. What does that name of the band mean? I'm not sure. Something about truth or believing that something is true, maybe. Bing. Next word is credent. Adjective from 1602. One is archaic, and it means giving credence. And then the synonym for that is confiding. So you're giving the truth, you're giving the belief of the truth to something. Number two is obsolete. The synonym is credible. Ba-kung! Next word is credential. First form, adjective from the 15th century. Warranting credit or confidence. And this is used chiefly in the phrase credential letters. Credential letters, and then in the previous one we had the phrase letters of credence, which also could be credentials. So yeah, who's using these letters? Credential letters, letters of credence. Is it in the law world? I feel like it probably would be, but I'm not sure. Ba-king! Next word is the second form of credential, noun from 1655. One, something that gives a title to credit or confidence. And then also the 3A definition for the word qualification. Something that gives a title to credit. So you have a credit, a title to credit, or somebody has confidence in you. You have credentials, qualifications. But man, I want that shirt. That word should be qualification. Somebody's probably done something with that. Number two is plural, so this would be credentials. Testimonials or certified documents showing that a person is entitled to credit or has a right to exercise official power. Something that says somebody can do what they say they can do, kind of, basically. Number three, synonyms are certificate and diploma. I think the only credentials I have are my college graduation diploma that says that I am allowed to talk about films and maybe make films. That's literally the only credentials I have. Okay. Ba-king! Next word is the third form of credential. This is a transitive verb from 1888. To furnish with credentials. As in, to credential adequate academic performance. And that is a quote from K. Patricia Cross. To credential adequate academic performance. You're giving something credentials. Okay. Next word. It's all related. A lot of these are related. Ba-king! It is credentialism. Credentialism. Noun from 1967. Undue emphasis on credentials as prerequisites to employment. And examples of those credentials would be college degrees. So what is this? Credentialism, undue emphasis. Undue, it was unnecessary? No, there's a better way to phrase that. Undue emphasis. Emphasis on something that should not be emphasized. Undue emphasis on credentials as prerequisites to employment. So I think it's saying that you're giving we could use another word, too much credence to the credentials. Like, you have to have this college degree to get this job, but maybe the person is still fairly qualified for this job. So it's that credential. You need credentials to get this job. I think that's what it's saying. Oftentimes that makes sense, but not all the time. You got to give people a chance. Maybe they couldn't go to college for some reason. You don't know their situation. Okay, next. Bing! It is credenza. C-R-E-D-E-N-Z-A. Noun from 1880. One, it is the number three definition for the word credence, which is a Renaissance sideboard used chiefly for valuable plate. Number two, a sideboard, buffet, or bookcase patterned after a Renaissance credence, but especially one without legs. And we have a picture of this credenza. It looks like a cabinet with no legs, two drawers near the top, a couple of cabinet doors below those, and then on both the left and the right sides, there are some shelves. They have, let's see, three right angles, but then what would be the fourth right angle is curved. So it's like it's a triangle with one of the hypotenuse is curved, if you like it in those terms. And then, yeah, just the top of it is, it's a shelf. You can put stuff on it, but the front two corners are curved. So we can post a picture of a credenza. What is the number three definition of credence, though? It's this Renaissance sideboard. How is it different from this number two definition? It's a little confusing, but it's fine. It's fine. I'll let it go. This is Italian. Credenza. No, that was bad. I say it like Mario. Credenza. It's a me, Mario. Maybe that would be a fun sound effect one day. So anyway, credenza, Italian, literally means belief or confidence. And how that got turned into a sideboard, buffet, or bookcase, that's very confusing to me. Belief, and do you have belief or confidence that this thing is going to hold your stuff? I need some more context. Okay, ba-ging! Next word is credibility. Noun from 1594. I have no credentials to say that I have credibility to be the one who is reading the dictionary to you, but I am doing it, so that's just what you're stuck with. Okay, credibility. Number one, the quality or power of inspiring belief, as in an account lacking in credibility. I have to believe that account is like somebody is telling their account of a story of what happened. But if it lacks in credibility, then that means that maybe they're not telling the truth. I will always tell you the truth. Unless I'm trying to be funny or sarcastic, then I won't. But sometimes it's hard to tell when I'm telling a joke. Okay, two, for credibility, capacity for belief, as in strains her reader's credibility. Strains her reader's credibility. Quote from the Times Literary Supplement. There's no etymology. So next is bing, credibility gap. That is the word gap, like the clothes store. Do they still exist? They must. Of course they do. Okay, two words. Noun from 1966, 1A, lack of trust, as in a credibility gap between generations. The older generation doesn't trust the younger generation, and the younger generation doesn't trust the older generation. They've got no credibility to each other. 1B, lack of believability, as in a credibility gap created by contradictory official statements. And that is a quote from Samuel Ellenport. Lack of believability. A credibility gap created by contradictory official statements. So there are official statements that contradict each other, and that's not, that doesn't help anybody. So yes, there's a credibility gap between them. Number two, the synonym is discrepancy, as in the credibility gap between the professed ideals and their actual practices. And that is also a quote from Jean L. Noble. Okay, we have one more word for this episode. Begoong. It is credible. Incredible. C-R-E-D-I-B-L-E. Adjective from the 14th century. One, offering reasonable grounds for being believed, as in a credible account of an accident. It's a very believable account. Also as in credible witnesses. If you have credible witnesses, if they are to be believed, then maybe their accounts of the accident are credible. Two, of sufficient capability to be militarily effective, as in a credible deterrent, also as in credible forces. Credibly is an adverb. It feels so weird not to have I-N before this word, incredible, incredibly. But, okay, so I honestly don't know if I've ever thought about it, but credible is the opposite of incredible. Incredible basically means something that is probably difficult to be believed. Credible is to be believed. Incredible is, whoa, it is so amazing that I can't even believe it. It is incredible. Why isn't it uncredible? Should it be uncredible? Discredible? Those are maybe different. The etymology isn't helpful, but of course, you know, you can look back at all these other words in this episode, and it's all about being believed. Okay, so the words in this episode were creche, cred, credence, credent, credential, credentialism, credenza, credibility, credibility gap, and credible. It's hard to just process what these words even mean after reading them all, because they were kind of so similar. It's word of the episode time. What am I going to pick? I mean, it's probably going to be either credential or credibility. I don't know. Do I pick it for myself? What do I feel like? Do I pick it for... I don't know. I think it's good to be credible, to have credibility. Even if you don't have credentials, you can still be credible. Credibility, maybe we'll pick that. Because I just think it is good for you to be honest, have truth, speak the truth, be true to yourself, make people trust in you, be accountable and credible, and have credibility. Have credibility as a person. Be true to yourself and everybody around you. All right, I think that was fine. And that is a good place to end this episode. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. I feel like I don't emphasize my words as much as I should sometimes. Word nerds. Hello, how are you? This is Spencer coming at you from, what is today? March 6th, 2022. I'm coming from the past. I'm a time traveler, but only in one direction. It's not very interesting. Okay, let us read the words. The first word is credit, C-R-E-D-I-T, first form, noun from 1537, 1. Reliance on the truth or reality of something. Reliance, you were relying on the truth or the reality of something. Yeah, that's a good thing to do, I guess. As in, gave credit to everything he said. 2A, the balance in a, wow, there's a lot of definitions. The balance in a person's favor in an account. We're talking about the bank account, their money account. The balance, the positive amount that you have. It's not a negative balance. That would be debit. That would be debt. But this is credit. So you have a positive amount. You have money in your account. That is the credit. Okay. 2B, an amount or sum placed at a person's disposal by a bank. When they give you money, they are giving you a credit. 2C, the provision of money, goods, or services with the expectation of future payment, as in long-term credit. Also, there's more to the definition. Money, goods, or services so provided, as in exhausted their credit. They had all of these things at their disposal, money, goods, services, and then they finished them up. If you go to a store, they may say, well, we can't give you a refund in cash or on your credit card, but we could give you store credit. So that means you have money to spend, but only at this store. Sometimes it's fine. Some people don't like it. Usually it's fine. If it's a store you shop at often, you might as well just do it. 2D1, an entry on the right-hand side of an account constituting an addition to a revenue, net worth, or liability account. Let's see what this one says. Maybe that'll help us. 2D2, a deduction from an expense or asset account. I would not have guessed that that would be called a credit, but it depends on the context. 2E, any one of or the sum of the items entered on the right-hand side of an account. I have a feeling that they keep on saying right-hand. We've seen that twice now. Is because when you're doing like the bank ledger, there must be certain columns that are designated for certain things. So maybe the left column is for money going out and the right column is for money coming in. So that's why, I guess, maybe, possibly. 2F, a deduction from an amount otherwise due. 3A, influence or power derived from enjoying the confidence of another or others. 3B, good name. That's all it says, good name. You have a good name, and the synonym is esteem, E-S-T-E-E-M. But then also financial or commercial trustworthiness. Number 4 is archaic, and the synonym is credibility. 5, a source of honor, as in a credit to the school. A credit, that person who is a credit to the school, they have given that school honor. Yeah. 6A, something that gains or adds to reputation or esteem. The synonym is honor, H-O-N-O-R, as in took no credit for his kindly act. I do feel like a lot of people these days, now that cameras are so easily accessible on our phones, that people will so many people try to take credit for their kindly acts, either saving an animal or giving money or food to a homeless person or something like that. They film it because they want to get the recognition, the credit for the thing that they did. And it's good that they're doing the thing that they did, but I feel like just do the good thing. You don't have to get credit for it. The important part of this is the thing that you did. And I just feel like when you take videos or photos of the thing and then you put it out there in the world, you are very specifically asking for recognition to yourself, not of the, it should be about the thing that you acted kindly towards. You know, I'm a sucker for that stuff. I love seeing those things, so I enjoy watching them, but it just feels a little bit odd. And then I question, did they create this situation just so they record it? Why would they be recording it in the first place? You know, there has to be some planning involved to record it. So I just get worried that sometimes people are creating bad situations just so they can seem like they are being kindly, and I don't know. Anyway, 6B. I'm probably overthinking it and being harsher than I need to be, but that's just my thought. Okay. 6B, the synonyms are recognition and acknowledgement, as in quite willing to accept underserved credit. 7. Recognition by name of a person contributing to a performance as a film or telecast. Let's read that one again. Recognition by name of a person contributing to a performance like a film or telecast. This is something that I am sort of working on now. We are, as I've mentioned in the past, in the very, very early stages of working on an animated film. I'm helping to produce this thing, and we're like making a simple little sort of teaser poster, and it has a small handful of the credits. So I have to keep track of all the people who are working on this film, because in the end of the movie, we will have a huge list of people who are credited. Might not be a huge list, but it'll be a good-sized list. They all need to be credited because they did something to create this. They helped to create this thing. I don't always read every name in the credits of a movie, but, you know, there's a lot of important people in there. Maybe just stay for the credits after a movie. As in, we have the example, the opening credits. Many years ago, movies would have all of the credits at the beginning of the movie, which I think is kind of cool, actually, that you were sort of forced to see the names of all the people before the movie even started. And then at a certain point, probably some person high up in the studio said, well, you know, we can get right to the movie and just put all those names at the end. And then all those people got kind of forgotten, I feel like. When did that happen? Maybe, I know, 60s, maybe? I want to say the 60s, I don't remember. Maybe the 50s. I'll see if I can look it up and put some information in the show notes. But at some point, there was a change. Maybe we need to bring that back. Okay. Where were we? Here we go, number 8A. Recognition by a school or college that a student has fulfilled a requirement leading to a degree. How many credits did you get at your school? Relatedly, 8B, the synonym is credit hour. I think most schools have, each class is a credit hour or a certain amount of credit hours. So if it's maybe a not very intensive class, it could be 1 credit hour or 2 credit hours. I think the average is probably 3 or 4. Again, depending on the school, the situation, there could be classes that are 6 credit hours. So it's going to be kind of intensive every week, but by the end of the semester or the quarter, you're going to have more credits towards that field. We have a couple more synonyms for everything for credit: belief and influence. That was so much information. What does the etymology say? From Old Italian, credito. From Latin, creditum, which is something entrusted to another, or a loan. From, oh yes, we saw this before, credere, which means to believe or entrust. So if you give somebody a credit of something, maybe it's money, maybe it's something else, you believe that they are worth entrusting that to them. Did that sentence make sense? I don't know. I had an idea for a sound effect, and it's been so long since I thought of this idea that I have completely forgotten what it was. Oh, I remember. It's just slam. Okay, second form of credit. This is a verb from circa 1530. It is transitive, and I'm trying to see if it is also intransitive. I'm not seeing it. Okay, one, to trust in the truth of, and the synonym is believe, as in find his story hard to credit. Two, to supply goods on credit to. Three is archaic, to bring credit or honor upon. 4a, to enter upon the credit side of an account. I would guess that that is the right-hand side. 4b, to place an amount to the credit of, as in credit his account with $10. If you want to give me $10, I will take your $10. If you wanted to do that every month, you might as well just join the Patreon and get some episodes early. 5a, to consider usually favorably as the source, agent, or performer of an action or the possessor of a trait, as in credits him with an excellent sense of humor. I think I have a weird sense of humor. Not everybody has the same sense of humor, which is why people don't usually understand my jokes. 5b, to attribute to some person, as in they credit the invention to him. What is this invention? A synonym for everything is the word ascribe. Next word, slam. The word is creditable. No. Creditable. 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 Adjective from 1526. 1. Worthy of belief, as in a creditable report. That report has, you can believe in that report. 2. Sufficiently good to bring esteem or praise, as in a creditable performance. 3. Worthy of commercial credit. 4. Capable of being assigned. Creditability is a noun. I overemphasize that so you could understand it. It is the word creditability. Creditableness. No, I'm adding syllables. Creditableness. Who uses this word? It is a noun. And creditably is an adverb. Slam. Next word, credit card. Two words, noun from 1888. A card authorizing purchases on credit. So, let's see. This isn't the type of credit that you... Okay, well, let's see. You're not getting credit. You're not, when you buy a thing, okay, let's backtrack here. If you get a credit card, this is explanations for people who probably don't have a credit card. You're given a credit card, you are given a certain amount of credit per month to use up. But the problem is a lot of people don't think of the money that they have from credit cards as real money. I don't know why people think of this sort of differently, but like, oh, it's like free money. No, it is not free money. You have to pay it back. And if you don't, you're going to get charged a fee, and then you're going to end up spending more money. So unless you are in a dire situation or whatever, try as much as you can, if and when you have a credit card, to only spend within your means so you can pay it off in full each month. If you can do that, you will get very good credit, your credit score will go up, and people will like you. That's sort of a, you know, that's a silly phrase. You'll have very good standing in the banking world. You know, I got my mixed feelings about the money world, the banking world, all that. But, you know, these days it's kind of necessary to have a credit card. And if you're going to do it smart. Only spend the things that you can actually afford each month and then just pay it off in full each month. I said that already. I said it again because it's important. Slam. Next is credit hour. Two words. The second word is H-O-U-R, like hours and minutes and seconds. Noun from circa 1927. The unit of measuring educational credit, usually based on the number of classroom hours per week throughout a term. And yeah, we talked about this before with credit, credit hours. How many hours per week are you in that class? That's generally the amount of credit hours you will get for that class. Slam. Next is credit line. Two words. Noun from 1899. One, the synonym is line of credit. Credit line, line of credit. Let's go line dancing on your credit line. Two, a line, note, or name that acknowledges the source of an item as a news dispatch or television program. Slam? Next is creditor. Creditor. Noun from the 15th century. One to whom a debt is owed. You owe a debt to somebody, they are the creditor. They have credit because you owe them money. That's you have a debt and they have a credit. Especially a person to whom money or goods are due. Next, slam. Credit union. Two words. Noun from 1881. A cooperative association that makes small loans to its members at low interest rates and offers other banking services as savings and checking accounts. So, similar sort of to a credit card, but not exactly. You can borrow money from a credit union, and so that's where you get that credit. But you see, that's the thing. It's a little bit confusing because you get a credit, but then you have to pay it. So it's like you're getting a future debt. A future debt is what you're getting. Kind of, sort of, I don't know. It's a weird way to think about it, maybe. And then, yeah, you will pay it off. You might need this money immediately so you can do something with it. A lot of people, I think, you know, they need to buy groceries, maybe. That's an important thing. You shouldn't need to have to borrow money to buy your groceries, but sometimes people do. Anyway, you borrow some money, a small loan, but you have to pay it off with an interest rate on top of it. So again, you're going to end up paying more money than what you borrowed, so it better be important, and you better know that you're going to have enough money in the future to pay it off, plus interest. Slam! Next word is credit worthy. One word, adjective from 1924, financially sound enough to justify the extension of credit. Credit worthiness is a noun. You or something is worth giving credit to. Next.
Slam.
Credo. C-R-E-D-O. You could also say credo. Noun from the 12th century. And the synonym is just the word creed. C-R-E-E-D. That'll be in tomorrow's episode. Oh, this is a Latin word. There you'd say credo. Credo in Latin, and it means I believe. I believe. What do I believe in? I believe that the next word is going to be the last word for this episode. Slam! It is the word credulity. You could say credulity, 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 C R E D U L I T Y, noun from the 15th century. Readiness or willingness to believe, especially on slight or uncertain evidence. So the words in this episode were credit, credit, creditable, credit card, credit hour, credit line, creditor, credit union, credit worthy, credo, and credulity. I guess I will pick credit card as the word of the episode because these things are just everywhere. Anybody who is at least 18 years old, most people have one. A lot of people don't want one. They want to live in the cash world, and that's fine, or some other means that's not an actual credit card. But I think as long as you're smart about it, as long as you don't buy things outside of your financial means, it's probably a pretty good idea to have a credit card, build up some credit, you pay it off in full, on time, your credit score is going to go up. Just be good with your money. Be good with your money and your credit card. All right, that is going to be the end of this episode. Yeah. It's kind of late in the day, so I'm going to go chill now. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye for now. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of The Dictionary. How are you all doing today? Thank you, great. Okay, so the first word in this episode is credulous. C-R-E-D-U-L-O-U-S. Adjective from 1576. 1. Ready to believe, especially on slight or uncertain evidence. As in, accused of swindling credulous investors. Let's see, it's been a little bit since I recorded the last episode, so I sort of have to remind myself. Let's see, credulity was the last word in the last episode. Readiness or willingness to believe, especially on slight... Oh, see, that one is... Yeah, it's very similar. Credulity and credulous. Yeah, I remember it's about the truth and believing. I think that's what it is. So, ready to believe something. It's kind of like gullible. Gullible, not quite to that level, but sort of. 2. For credulous. Proceeding from credulity. And that's proceeding, not preceding. As in, credulous superstitions. Credulously is an adverb, and credulousness is a noun. Let's see, the sound effect is going to be zzz. It's the sound of my brain frying. Zzz. Next is cree, C-R-E-E with a capital C. The plural is either cree or crees with an S. Noun from 1744. That's when it came into the American English language, but it was definitely a word way before that. 1. A member of an American Indian people of Quebec, Ontario, Manitoba, and Saskatchewan. That's all in Canada. I thought maybe they would have been in the United States of America region as well, but I guess not. 2. The Algonquin language of the Cree people. And of course, I say Canada and the United States of America. This was all their land beforehand. I'm just using the more modern words for these areas of land masses. So yeah, this is Canadian French from their word Cree, C-R-I-S, from the Ojibwa dialect word Christino or Kiristino? I don't know how to say that. That is a member of a band living south of James Bay. So I assume James Bay must be wherever. Quebec, Ontario, Manitoba, and Saskatchewan is sort of generally around there. Okay. Next word is creed with a D at the end. Noun from before the 12th century. 1. A brief authoritative formula of religious belief. 2. a set of fundamental beliefs, also a guiding principle. So it doesn't have to be religious necessarily. It's just your fundamental beliefs. What are your creeds? What do you believe? Let's see. Creedal, with two E's or just one E. That is an adjective. And this is from Latin credo, which is the first word of the Apostles and Nicene Creeds, from credere, which means to believe or trust or entrust. We've seen that before. Akin to the old Irish cretid, which means he believes. And then also from the Sanskrit sraddhadati. And it doesn't say what that means. Next, it is creek with a K. You could also say crick, which I often like to say. Oh, look at that bubbling crick over there. Noun from the 13th century. One. This one is chiefly British. A small inlet or bay, narrower and extending farther inland than a cove. So a cove is just a little area that goes, that's kind of like a bay, but this is, it goes further inland than a cove, and it is narrower. So it's like a large creek, to use the American way. Okay, so that was, yes, that was the more British one. Number two, a natural stream of water, normally smaller than and often, what? Normally smaller than and often tributary to a river. So it's just a break off of a river, but it's usually a lot smaller than a river. It's just a creek. You can probably hop over it in one step if you tried. Number three is archaic. It is a narrow or winding passage. The etymology just says that it is from the Old Norse kriki, K-R-I-K-I, and that might be a suffix, and that just means bend. So I thought it would have been more interesting than that. Not that that's uninteresting, but I thought there would have been more. Oh, look, we have a phrase, up the creek, and this is in a difficult or perplexing situation. A lot of times, people like to say, up the creek without a paddle. I'm in a difficult or perplexing situation, and I have no way to get out of it. Zzz. We have creek again, but this is a capital C, noun from 1725. One, an American Indian confederacy of peoples, chiefly of Muscogean stock, of Alabama, Georgia, and Florida. And I hope I said that word correctly. Muscogean, capital Muscogean. So it's a group of the indigenous people who live, hopefully still live, in the area that is Alabama, Georgia, and Florida, the southeastern area of the United States of America. Two, a member of any of the Creek peoples. Any of those groups of peoples, you could just call them Creek. Three, the Muscogean language of the Creek Indians. And again, I hope I said it correctly. Muscogean? Could it be Muscogean? I doubt it. Next, Creel, C-R-E-E-L, first form, noun from the 14th century, one, a wicker basket, as for carrying newly caught fish. So it's just a wicker basket. Usually people will use them to carry newly caught fish so they can take them home and then put them in a creek. Two, a bar with skewers for holding bobbins in a spinning machine. Spinning machine and bobbins and skewers. Okay, yeah, I only have the slightest bit of knowledge for what any of that means. Etymology doesn't say much. Why is it a wicker basket and also a bar with skewers? Do they look similar? Are they different? Why? But hey, look, we have a second form. Second form of Creole transitive verb from 1844. To put in a creel. And the example of what you are putting in the creel is fish that have been caught. I'm still a little bit curious about the bar with the skewers for holding bobbins in a spinning machine. Maybe those two just happen to get the same word. Language evolves, and in this area it became that thing, and this area that word became that thing. It's both things. Next. It is the word creep. C-R-E-E-P. First form, verb from before the 12th century. We are starting with intransitive, and it doesn't look like it is also transitive, so maybe it's just intransitive. 1A, to move along with the body prone and close to the ground. Prone means it's face down, belly down. Creeping along with your body, your face to the ground, and you're also very close to the ground. 1B, to move slowly on hands and knees. 2A, to go very slowly, as in the hours crept by. Crept, that is the past form, C-R-E-P-T. It doesn't look like you can say creeped, but I think you should be allowed to if you want to. Okay, 2B, to go timidly or cautiously so as to escape notice, as in she crept away from the festive scene. Why did she want to creep away from the festive scene? Maybe it was just too much excitement for her. Maybe she's an introvert, and she had done her extroversion for the day, and she had to creep away. Number 2C, to enter or advance gradually so as to be almost unnoticed, as in age creeps up on us. Oh, yes, it does. I can tell you from experience, all of a sudden, you don't even notice it. You're like, where did all the time go? Where did all of my good body feelings go? Why does everything hurt? Also is in, a note of irritation crept into her voice. What is a note of irritation? It's just a little, like if I say, a note of irritation crept into her voice. It's just a little bit of irritation there. 3, to have the sensation of being covered with creeping things. Some people might like that, most people do not. As in, the thought made her flesh creep. Number 4 is talking about a plant. So, to spread or grow over a surface, rooting at intervals, or clinging with tendrils, stems, or aerial roots. Let's see, what? I know vines, you could say that vines creep, but lots of other things. If they have tendrils, trying to find a place to grab onto, stems, aerial roots, those are roots that come from the top. I know there's at least one, a banyan tree, do they have aerial roots, I think? 5A, to slip or gradually shift position. 5B, to change shape permanently from prolonged stress or exposure to high temperatures. What does that? What changes shape permanently from stress or exposure? I mean, if something's at a high temperature, like if ice is at a high temperature, it's going to change into water, maybe even steam, but I don't know if you'd call it creep. That must be something else. Let's see, etymology. From Old English, kreopan, akin to the Old Norse krupa, which is K-R-J-U-P-A, and that just means to creep. So I guess we just get it from Old Norse. second form of creep. Noun from 1818. One, a movement of or like creeping, as in traffic moving at a creep. I think I mentioned this recently. That's just the worst. I don't remember why I said it, but there was some word that was related to that. Yeah. Okay. Number two, a distressing sensation like that caused by the creeping of insects over one's flesh. I don't need the book to be telling me more about how my skin can creep by thinking about insects or whatever. Especially a feeling of apprehension or horror. And this is usually used in plural with the word the, as in, that gives me the creeps. Is that the name of a movie? The Creeps? I know that there are other ones. I gotta do a quick look, because I feel like if there's not, there should be, right? Let's see. There's a movie called Creep, another movie called Creep, Creep 2, another movie called Creep, Creep 3. Of course, there's Creep Show. That's classic. But I don't know. There's a lot with the word creep. That is for sure. But, oh, here, The Creeps. Oh, it's just from last year. Did I see this movie? I don't remember, but I may have to. All right. Oh, and then there's a short. Yeah, so there's at least one movie called The Creeps. Good. That makes me happy. Okay. Number three for creep. A feed trough accessible only by young animals and used especially to supply special or supplementary feed, called also creep feeder. We are not going to see creep feeder, so that's just its own thing. But why is this called a creep? Maybe the young animals have to creep up to it to get. That's interesting. Number four, the slow change of dimensions of an object from prolonged exposure to high temperature or stress. That is, so in the previous one, that was the verb, the act of creeping. In this one, that whole thing is called creep. I still don't know what it's about. Number five, an unpleasant or obnoxious person. I think you could easily put some more adjectives into that definition for if you're going to call somebody a creep. Please don't be a creep. Number six, a slow but persistent increase or elevation, as in, this political inertia makes budget creeps. No, makes budget creep inevitable. This political inertia makes budget creep inevitable. That is from the Wall Street Journal. And that's basically just saying that with all this political stuff, the budgets are creeping up slowly. There is no additional etymology for that. We have one more word. It is creepage. C-R-E-E-P-A-G-E. Noun from 1903. Gradual movement. And the synonym is just creep. So people don't really use creepage so much anymore. Okay, the words were credulous, cree, creed, creak, creek, creel, creel, creep, creep, and creepage. Well, let's see. We got, Well, let's look ahead. What do we got going on tomorrow? Just looking to see. Oh, man, there's some good stuff in tomorrow's episode. That's going to be exciting. Well, I think maybe I will pick the word creep as the word of the episode because just from a, this number five definition, an unpleasant or obnoxious person, I feel very strongly that people should not act like creeps. There is a song, 'cause I'm a creep. Is that how it goes? I sort of know it. I just sang a song. Don't be a creep. It's really not becoming. Don't do it. Yeah, just don't be a creep. it's not that hard. So that's all I got to say about that. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye.
Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary.
This is the podcast where I read the book and I tell you what I think about the things that I read in the book. Oh, yes, I do. Okay, let us read this first word, creeper, C-R-E-E-P-E-R, noun from before the 12th century. One that creeps, as 1A, a creeping plant, 1B, a bird that creeps about on trees or bushes searching for insects. And they could be from the family Cerithidae. That's how I'm going to say how that word is pronounced. Cerithidae. Okay, they're just creeping about around the trees and the bushes looking for insects. 1C, a creeping insect or reptile. Maybe the creeping insect is being creeped by the creeper bird. Number 2, any of various devices used for creeping. What might these be? 2A, a fixture with iron points worn on the shoe to prevent slipping. A fixture with iron... Are those like the crampons? Iron points worn on the shoes to prevent slipping. So they allow you to creep and not... They allow you to be a creeper and not a slipper. 2B, a low-wheeled platform for supporting the body when working under an automobile. That thing is called a creeper? I guess you're sort of... You're creeping under the car. What would I have called it? A dolly. I think I would probably call it a dolly. Number 3, a usually one-piece garment for a child at the crawling age. What sort of garment is this? Is it a onesie? Is it something else? Is it called a creeper because that is what they wear when they're crawling and creeping and crawling? I don't know. Maybe. I don't have no kids, so I don't know. Okay, the sound effect is going to be hi-ya. I don't know. Something. Next word is creeping. Adjective from the 14th century. Yes. Developing or advancing by slow, imperceptible degrees. As in, a period of creeping inflation. Just gradually creeping up. Things are getting more and more expensive. Yeah, sometimes it's not so slow. Sometimes it's very fast. Like right now, I'm living through the gas prices in March that are going crazy up because of reasons. Hiya! Next is creeping eruption. Two words, noun from 1926. This seems like a paradox. Creeping and eruption. Eruption is a very quick thing, and creeping seems like it's a very slow thing. So what is this? It is a skin disorder marked by a spreading red line of eruption and caused especially by, by larvae burrowing beneath the human skin. Okay, so the larvae, as in the examples, hookworms, not normally parasitic in humans. Hookworms that are not normally parasitic in humans, but maybe sometimes they are. Okay, try to avoid those hookworms if you can. This sounds terrible. I hope nobody has ever had to experience that, although clearly people have if it's a thing. A creeping eruption. Heya! Next is creepy. Creep with a Y. Adjective from 1836. 1. Producing a nervous, shivery apprehension, as in a creepy horror story. Also just the synonym eerie. 2. Of relating to or being a creep. Annoyingly unpleasant. Please, like I said in the last episode, don't be creepy. It's not that hard to do. Just don't be creepy. Creepily is an adverb, and creepiness is a noun. Heya. Next is, no more creepy words, we have now cremains. C-R-E-M-A-I-N-S. Cremains. Noun from 1947. The ashes of a cremated human body. And we have this word because it is a combination of cremated and remains. So all we had to do is put a C before the word remains, and we have cremains. I think there is the idea that if when a body is cremated, it's just perfect ash. But I've heard that it's sometimes it's not just ash, like they present to you in movies and TV shows. Sometimes there's hunks of bone. Why are we talking about this? I'm just being real with you. Okay, next word. Heya. It is cremate or cremate. Yes, this is the verb version of basically what we read before. Transitive verb from 1874. To reduce to ashes by burning. Could be lots of things, but the main example is a dead body. Cremation, or just cremation, that is a noun. Let's see. This is from the Latin cremare, the Latin verb cremare, which means to burn up or cremate. There's nothing more than that. Cremare means to burn up. I wish that there was something more specific, but that's about all we got there. I don't know why. Okay. What do you want to do? Do you want to be cremated? Do you want to be buried? Do you want to be turned into a tree? Do you want to be turned into a diamond? These are all possibilities. There's other things too. I don't know. If you want to let me know, you know how to get a hold of me, I think. Email, Instagram, Twitter, voicemail, things like that. I still don't know what I want to do. Hiya. Next word is crematorium. Noun from 1880. You could say crematorium or crematorium. The synonym is just crematory or crematory, which is our next word. Hiya. Crematory, or also, yes, crematory. Noun from 1876, a furnace for cremating, and then also an establishment containing such a furnace. Crematory or crematory is also an adjective. I would have assumed that crematorium would be the word that gets used more between these two, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe that's an old school way to say that word. And crematory or crematory is a more common usage these days. I'm sure we could talk so much more about that, but, you know, not everybody's interested in learning about that or want to talk about that because people don't like to talk about death. So instead, we are going to now get into a whole new section. This is flavors and tasty things and liquids and desserts. Okay, so this first word is, you can pronounce it creme or cream or crème. You could say crème if you want. Creme, cream, crème. It is spelled C-R-E-M-E, and you can spell it with an accent on the first E if you want, and that accent goes pew, up on the left and down on the right. This is a noun from circa 1821. 1. A sweet liqueur. 2. Cream or a preparation made with or resembling cream used in cooking. And then 3 is the 2B definition for the word cream, spelled C-R-E-A-M. And now I am very curious to go back to that and see how, what are, that one is just pronounced cream. That's just the one way that you can say that word. But when you spell it C-R-E-M-E, you can pronounce it three different ways. Let's see. Not so much in the etymology. Hey-ya! Next is... Well, so a bunch of these words are all going to start with that first word, creme or cream or crame. I think I'll say creme because it seems more appropriate. It's a French word, by the way. Creme. And then this one is anglaise. Creme anglaise. And you can pronounce that a few ways. Anglaise, anglaise. It is spelled, that second word is spelled A-N-G-L-A-I-S-E. Noun from 1975. It is a vanilla-flavored custard sauce, usually served with desserts. It is French, and it literally means English cream. So yes, crème is cream, and anglaise is English. And, did the English people, did they make this vanilla-flavored custard sauce, or were the French just like, oh, it's vanilla-flavored and, very vanilla, quote-unquote vanilla, and boring, and so we're just going to call it English, because that's how they, I don't know, I'm just making stuff up. Okay. Hey-ya! Next is crème brûlée. You could also do that sort of fancy French thing, crème brûlée. I can't do it so good. That word is spelled B-R-U-L-E-E, and there is an accent on the U. It is the hat carrot accent, and then there is also an accent on the first E, which goes boop. This is a noun from 1886. It is a rich custard topped with caramelized sugar, and they use a flamey thing to make that sugar on top all caramelized. And so it gets very dark, and then you break it with the spoon, and it crackles all over the place. Crème brûlée is French, and it literally means scorched cream. So brûlée is scorched. I don't know any other French words. I wonder... There must be something else in English, or at least Latin, that's in that world that means scorched. I don't know. I want to learn more about that word. Okay, we are on our next one. Hey-ya. Crème caramel. Crème caramel. It's spelled like it sounds. Let's see. It says, or you can see the word caramel, which is spelled the same way. Maybe they mentioned it there. I don't remember. Crème caramel, noun from 1906. It is a custard that has been baked with caramel sauce. And this is just means, literally in French, caramel cream. There's so many different ways that you can make these custardy cream things. You can bake it with caramel sauce, then you can scorch the top of it, you can throw some vanilla-flavored custard on it. What would that be? If we just combine these three, it would be a crème caramel brûlée anglaise. Hiya! Next is... Okay, this one's fun. You can pronounce it a few ways. You can say it... Bui, let's see... Crème de cacao or cream de coco. I assume you can combine those. You can say cream de cacao or crème de coco. And then you can also pronounce it crème or cream cacao. I have never heard of that one. I've only heard of the first two. But you can say crème de cacao. It is spelled crème, second word, D-E, third word, C-A-C-A-O. I like to say crème de cacao. It is a noun from circa 1878, a sweet brown or colorless liqueur flavored with cacao beans and vanilla. It's brown or colorless. I think I might have said and. That which doesn't make any sense. It can't be brown and colorless. It is a liqueur, and it is flavored with cacao beans. So that might be a little bit on the chocolatey side, and then also vanilla. So you get that swirl of flavors. This stuff's pretty good. I don't think we have any in the house right now, but I should go get some. Again, it is French. It literally means cream of cacao. So they've just been creamified. Is that a word? I don't think so. Hey-ya. Next word is creme de cassis. So similar to creme de cacao, it's the same first two words, and then the third word is C-A-S-S-I-S. Creme de cassis. Noun from 1899. It is a liqueur made from black currants. Currants or currants? We will learn about how to pronounce that word later. Much later. When later? Let's see. I'm looking ahead. Why do you care to know when we're going to get to that word? I don't know. You asked me to check, so I'm checking. Let's see. It looks like it's going to be June 8th is when that episode is going to air. Black currants. I think that's a fruit. So, yeah, this literally means cream of black currants. But why is it cassis? How did it go from currants to cassis? That's what I wonder about. Hey-ya. Next is creme de la creme. Creme de la creme. It's just the same word at the beginning and the end. Let's see. I think that's the only... You could probably say creme de la creme if you want. Or maybe creme de la creme. But I like creme de la creme. Noun from 1848, and it just means the very best. It's French. It literally means cream of the cream. So you got the cream. And then, didn't we have cream of the crop before? Was that a phrase? I think just in cream, it was like the top, the best stuff. Yeah. So, you know, the cream de la cream is the best of the best. Okay, next. Hey-ya! Creme de menthe, or cream de menthe, or creme de mint, or creme de menthe. All of those are fine. It is creme de, and then the third word is M-E-N-T-H-E. Noun from circa 1878. A lot of these are from the 1800s. That's when they were going crazy, making flavored liqueurs where they creamed things. Okay, creme de menthe, a sweet green or colorless mint-flavored liqueur. And, of course, it literally means cream of mint. When they say cream of mint, cream of black currant, cream of the other one, cacao, are they literally creaming them? Are they blending them to make a cream? Or is it more of a, like, an extract? I would assume it's more of an extract, but I'm not entirely sure. I don't know how the French are using that word cream. But, hey, it's stuck. This is what we've got. These are the names of these liqueurs. And I love them all, and I want them all, because they're very sweet and tasty. If you combine creme de menthe and creme de cassis and creme de cacao, you will have a very interesting flavored drink. Mint, black currants, and cacao / vanilla. Next word. I don't think this is an alcohol or liqueur. Hey-ya, hey-ya. The word is creme fraiche, or cream fraiche, or crème fraîche. Same first word. Second word is F-R-A-I-C-H-E. And you can, if you want, put an accent on the I, which is, again, that little carrot hat accent. It, the sound it makes is ee. Okay, this is a noun from 1950. It is heavy cream, thickened, and slightly soured with buttermilk, and often served on fruit. Heavy cream, buttermilk. Is that it? There must be other ingredients. It's French. It literally means fresh cream. Is it that fresh, though? How fresh is it? I don't know. Maybe it tastes fresh because it's a little, it's slightly soured. Why would that? I would say that's the opposite of fresh. If something is slightly soured, I would think that it's the opposite of fresh. It feels, it tastes, it's gone bad, maybe. But hey, people like it. I don't know if I've ever had it before. There was a very silly South Park episode about creme fraiche, I think I remember. Not for kids, probably. Hey, yeah. Next word is cremini. I guess that's how you say it. Cremini. I would probably want to say cremini, but no, it's cremini. C-R-E-M-I-N-I, or you can spell it with all I's. No E's, just I's. Cremini. Noun from 1984. It is a meaty, cultivated brown or tan mushroom that is of the same variety of button mushroom as the larger and more mature portobello. Wait, what did that say? Is of the same variety. Okay, so button mushroom is the variety. So these are button mushrooms. And also in that family, in that variety, are the larger and more mature portobello mushroom. This is, where did it go? Italian. It is the plural of cremino, from crema, which means cream, which is probably talking about their color. And there's more at the word cream. So that's what cremini mushrooms are. They're just cream-colored mushrooms. I'm not a big fan of mushrooms. People say, oh, you get the right kinds, you cook it up in the right way, it's, you know, tastes meaty, it doesn't taste very mushroomy, but I have not found that to be exactly the case. I'm trying to be better. Maybe I'll try some of these creminis. I should do a whole thing where I just try all of the mushrooms out there and see if I like any of them. But, yeah. They're not, I don't know, my brain, my taste buds, they're not loving it. Hey, we have one more word for this episode. Hey, yeah. Hey, yeah.
Hey, yeah. Hey, yeah.
It is crenate. Crenate. C-R-E-N-A-T-E. Adjective from 1688. Having the margin or surface cut into rounded scallops, as in a crenate leaf. Or possibly crenated. You can use that too. Crenated. Having the margin or surface cut into rounded scallops. So like the edge of the leaf is like has a bunch of rounded things on it? Maybe? Let's see. This is from Middle Latin crena, which means notch. So yes, the leaf has been notched, I guess. Okay, so I have to read the words to you now. Creeper, creeping, creeping eruption, creepy, cremains, cremate, crematorium, crematory, creme, creme anglaise, creme brulee, creme caramel, creme de cacao, creme de cassis, creme de la creme, creme de menthe, creme fraiche, cremini, and crenate. Oh, this is a difficult one. This is so difficult. I'm definitely not going to pick the mushrooms. I'm sorry, all you mushroom lovers, but I'm not picking it. You can pick it for yourself. I was kind of tempted to pick cremate because I think that's a pretty important thing to talk about just in life. Just death, you know, death. Should I have a guest on for that, for the word death? Who would I have on for that? But then all these other things are so good and tasty. Creme brulee, creme caramel, creme de coco, creme de cassis, creme de... Or do I pick creme de la creme? Can I pick more than one? Why? I'm just making up the rules myself. Who cares? Let's see. You know, there's nothing really jumping out at me. I like cremate. I like creme brulee, creme caramel. I like them all. Let's do something different, because I clearly can't decide, and I have no decision-making skills whatsoever. I will pick Creeping Eruption as the word of the episode because maybe we can have some fun with the song. I got a creeping eruption on my face. I got some larvae from a hookworm in my face. My face is erupting. It's very creepy. It's a creeping eruption. All right. You know what's up with all this stuff. Thank you very much for listening. I have almost, my wife and I, Sharon, we have almost finished the after party, finally. One more episode to go. Maybe we'll watch it tonight. It's very good. Very silly, very good, very smart. And what else? I think that's it for now. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Here is my jingle. This is the podcast where I read the dictionary and I tell you all the things that I think about it and somebody can say hello, hello, hello. Okay, I really don't think anybody should be listening to this podcast, and that's my opinion, but hey, you're here, I guess, maybe. Who? I don't know. Okay, this is the last section of page 294. So you can please go contact me if you want on Twitter and Instagram at dictionarypod. You can email me dictionarypod@gmail.com. There is a Google Voice number in the show notes that should work. You can call it and leave a voicemail. And obviously, you gotta go share this podcast with other people who you think might like it and rate it, review it, hit the stars and type some things. And then I will read it and I will feel very good that people are saying stuff about it. Even if it's bad, that means you listened. If you just have anything that you want to talk about, let me know. If you have specific thoughts about words that are coming up in the future, probably at least a month from now, well into the future, pick any word you want. Email me a voice memo, leave me a voicemail, tell me what you want to say, and I will put it in the episode when that airs. If you want to be a guest for something specific, maybe we'll figure that out. I don't know. We'll talk about that later. Okay, the first word in this episode is crenation. C-R-E-N-A-T-I-O-N. This is probably going to be related to yesterday's last word, which was crenate. It was all about scallops and notches. So crenation, noun from 1846. 1A, a crenate formation, especially one of the rounded projections on an edge. And what edge are we talking about? We're talking about a coin. So I guess the edge of a coin, it's got those little bumps. I guess that would be crenation. But not all coins have that. Why do they have that? Tell me. 1B, the quality or state of being crenate. 2, shrinkage of red blood cells resulting in crenate margins. Where are these margins? They're in the blood vessels? Why? What is happening? Shrinkage? The blood cells shrink? I'm not going to be able to figure this out on my own. I need some help. Okay. Sound effect. We're going to do boop. Next word is crenellated. Crenellated. C-R-E-N-E-L-L-A-T-E-D. You can spell it one L or two L's. Adjective from circa 1823, and it means having crenellations, as in a crenellated wall. What are crenellations, you would be asking, probably. That is going to be our next word, but first I have to look at the etymology. From French, crenellare, which means to furnish with embrasures. I'm very confused. Also from Old French crenelle, which is an embrasure. It's the diminutive of cren, which is notch. From crenere, which means to notch. So embrasures are like notches of things, and then if you put them in there, it's crenellated. Okay, boop. Next word is crenellation. Again, one L or two L's. Noun from 1849. Number one, the synonym is battlement. Number two, any of the embrasures alternating with merlins in a battlement. And merlins is M-E-R-L-O-N, battlement. It says to see the battlement illustration. So, of course, you know, we read this before, but we have to remind ourselves, what does this look like? Okay, yeah, the top of a castle, it's got the ups and the downs, the squares, the square ups and the downs. You know, there's the spaces are probably for archers to shoot arrows out of. You know what this is. That is a battlement. And so, yeah. Oh, and then number one, the crenellations, that's the part where it goes down. And then the number two is the part that goes up. Those are the merlins. So, yeah, the crenellations, it's like they've been notched out. The rook piece on a chessboard, it looks like a tiny little castle tower. The top has probably got these ups and the downs. The crenellations and the merlins, the peaks and the valleys. Instead of peaks and valleys, I'll say crenellations and merlins. Okay, well, we're going to talk about that again, probably when we get to the word merlin, and I will forget all about this again. Okay. So, boop. Next word is crenshaw. Noun from 1955. A winter melon having smooth green and gold skin and sweet salmon-colored flesh. It just sounded very nice. I want somebody else to read that. Okay, this is probably from the name Crenshaw or Cranshaw. Whose name was this? Did they invent this melon, this winter melon that has such a smooth green and gold skin? Green and gold. How is it both? And the flesh is colored like a salmon, but it is sweet. Probably tastes like a fruit. Crenshaw. Next word. Boop. It is crenulated, or just crenulate. Adjective, or you could also say crenulate. Crenulate, crenulate, crenulated. Adjective from 1777. Having an irregularly wavy or serrated outline, as in a crenulated shoreline. It's like it's been notched out. Crenulation is a noun. Yep, I think you know. You can figure that out. Next word. Boop. It is creole. C-R-E-O-L-E. Adjective from 1737. Number one and number two are both often capitalized. One, of or relating to Creoles or their language. And that is a Creoles with a capital C. And we're going to talk about that one next. But first, number two, relating to or being highly seasoned food typically prepared with rice, okra, tomatoes, and peppers, as in shrimp Creole. I love the flavors of Creole food, but I am confused. Well, no, I'm not confused. We have to learn about the capital C Creole so we can learn a bit more about this. But yes, the food is tasty, tasty. Okay. Boop-a-doop-boop. Boop. Next word is Creole with a capital C, noun from 1737. One, a person of European descent born especially in the West Indies or Spanish America. Spanish America. So is that, what part are we talking about? The United States of America, the Spanish region of that? Are we talking about Central America? Are we talking about South America? There's obviously all of those have a very Spanish influence. But yes, I guess a person of European descent born in those areas would be Creole. But there's more. 2. A white person descended from early French or Spanish settlers of the U.S. Gulf states and preserving their speech and culture. So, you know, Louisiana, that's a big one. But Louisiana, there's a lot of cultures, a lot of colors of people, a lot of great stuff going on. So there's more. 3. A person of mixed French or Spanish and black descent speaking a dialect of French or Spanish. That's very complicated. Pick one. No, you don't have to pick one, obviously. But yeah, that's a, there's a lot of stuff going on there. 4A. A language evolved from pigeonized French that is spoken by blacks in southern Louisiana. And yeah, you know, maybe I will find an audio example of somebody talking like this, because it's very specific to that region, and yeah.
Monte en forme créole. Monte est né ici, et moi juste l'aime parler créole.
4B, we just have the synonym Haitian, and. Yes, that I think they speak a form of French, Haitian French, maybe. I don't know, maybe it's just completely French. But you know, they're also they're not in southern Louisiana, they're in Haiti, but of course they travel around and they are largely black people. So that's there's a lot of Creole, I guess they're called Creole. I guess I would have said Haitian, maybe both are fine. Then we have 4C. This one would not be capitalized. It is a language that has evolved from a pigeon, not the bird pigeon, a pigeon, but serves as the native language of a speech community. Yeah, it's been combined, this whole Creole thing, both the culture and the language and the people, they've been combined between European and French and Spanish and I guess Haiti and probably other areas where people are much darker skin, black skin. So there's all these things mixing together, and they have created this Creole thing, which obviously there's a language to it. There's food. The language has also you know, even if it's spoken in English, it still has words. It has a lyricism to it. That's a thing. There was that guy. What was his name? Justin something, the cook on PBS, and he always said, "I guarantee." He was like the Creole cook, I think might have been what he was called. But man, that food, it is some tasty food. Not that I've had a lot of it, but yeah. Okay, so yeah, here we go with the etymology. From French, Creole, but also from Spanish, Criollo. Criollo? How do you say that? Criollo. Also from Portuguese, Criollo, which means, here we go, white person born in the colonies. And I have to assume that the colonies are, where would they be? Like, not the American colonies, the colonies in the Caribbean, probably, maybe other places. That was probably not the most nice word at the time, but now I think people have probably embraced it. I don't know. There's a lot of information with that one word. Hey, let's learn a little bit more about it. Boop. Next is Creolize with an S-E, British variation of Creolize with a Z, which is the next word. Boop. Creolize. Verb from circa 1932. A cause to become a Creole in a speech community. And the cause says it is a pigeonized language. Oh, it's to cause? Did I say to cause or a cause? I don't know. To cause a pigeonized language to become a Creole in a speech community. I'm confused. But anyway, that's, yes, it's been pigeonized. It's been evolved. I think that's a good way to say pigeonized. It has been combined with other things. It has evolved. It's a version of that language. Creolize. Creolize the language. Creolization. Creolization. That is a noun. I would like my food to be creolized. Next word.
Boop.
Creosote. Creosote. First form, noun from 1835. 1. A clear or yellowish, flammable, oily liquid mixture of phenolic compounds obtained by the distillation of tar derived from wood and especially from beech wood. I have heard of this. I'm only sort of familiar with it. I think it is a thing that you can, it comes from wood. You can make it into this, like a creosote block, and then you can burn it or something. Okay, number 2, a brownish, oily liquid consisting chiefly of aromatic hydrocarbons obtained by distillation of coal tar and used especially as a wood preservative. Those were both liquids, oily liquids, so maybe I'm wrong about this, but it's a thing that it's flammable, I think. Number 3, a dark brown or black flammable tar deposited from especially wood smoke on the walls of a chimney. And 4, the synonym is creosote bush, which we will learn about very soon, very soon. Etymology, from Greek, creosote, with a K, a capital K. Also from Greek, krios, which means flesh, and soter, which means preserver. So it's a flesh preserver. That is what creosote is. Also from sozine, which means to preserve. From sos, S-O-S, which means safe. Oh, that's interesting. Also, probably akin to the Sanskrit taviti, which means he is strong. There's so much going on here. I'm not sure. And then also, from its sos is safe, from its antiseptic properties, and there's more at the word raw. So yeah, if you got a chimney, there's probably some creosote up there, and then it's other stuff too. This oily liquid that's flammable, so be careful. Boop your nose. Second form of creosote is a transitive verb from 1836, and it means to treat with creosote. Probably it's the wood preservative. You're going to treat the wood with creosote. Boop. Next word is creosote bush. 2 words. Noun from 1846. It is a resinous desert shrub of the caltrop family found in the southwestern U.S. and Mexico. And the scientific or species name of this resinous desert shrub is Larea tridentata. Larea tridentata, the creosote bush. And our last word, boop. It is crepe, C-R-E-P-E. Or you can put an accent on the first E, which is the hat carrot, boo. Noun from 1750. 1. A light, crinkled fabric woven of any of various fibers. Number 2. It is the number 2 definition for the word crepe, spelled C-R-A-P-E, which is, is this the hat or the sleeve? That might be what that is, or the cover or the shroud. Number 3 for crepe. Crude rubber in the form of nearly white to brown crinkled sheets used especially for shoe soles, as in crepe-soled shoes. Never heard of crepe used in that way. Although, actually, I guess crepe paper, that's a very wrinkly paper. It's probably related to that. And then 4, a small, very thin pancake. You can make it sweet and you can make it savory. It all depends on what you put into it. Crepe is also an adjective, and crepey is an adjective. And the etymology doesn't have much, but it says you can go back to the word crepe, C-R-A-P-E, And there's more information there, possibly. Curly. Curly and crispy. That's basically what it is. And yes, the crepe, the little thin pancake, the edges definitely get crispy. And I guess if you roll it up, it's curly. Okay, so the words today were crenation, crenellated, crenellation, crenshaw, crenulated, creole, creole, creolize, creolize, creosote, 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 bush, and crepe. Well, I am tempted to pick crepe, but I think if I had to pick one for the rest of my life, I would probably pick creole food. Because there's so many flavors going on, it's pretty great. All crepes, maybe you could have a creole crepe. How you got to put the creole flavors. Maybe there's a savory crepe that's a creole crepe, and you put the rice and the okra and the tomatoes and the peppers in there. Somebody's got to do that if it doesn't exist. Creole crepe. I want a creole crepe. We're going to put the flavors in the crepe and make it a creole crepe. It's savory. I think I have nothing else interesting to say to you right now. I probably do, but I can't think of anything. Hey, thank you to you if you're listening to this. I genuinely appreciate it. You really have no idea, because as far as I'm concerned, I'm just talking to myself. Just today, I checked the downloads for this podcast, this silly little podcast, and it was very, very high for today. So I think I must have gotten a new fan. What is today? March 10th. If you did that on March 10th, thank you very much. I appreciate it. That's all I got to say. Thank you for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of this podcast called The Dictionary. It is the podcast where I read the dictionary and I tell you the things that are in my head about all the things, a lot of the things. So it's just a collection of my thoughts. It's really more about me, my favorite subject, than the words. But it's all done through the lens of the English language. I am Spencer. I am your host. And we now need to read all this stuff. Oh, hey, I think, yesterday we had creosote bush, and I'm now realizing on the next column over, we have a picture of the creosote bush. I didn't even see that before. It looks like a plant. It's got some little branchy things, and there's leaves. A lot of the leaves look like they're in pairs of two. And then at the end of the branch, there's like a flower and some petals, and it looks like it shows different forms, different variations of the flower. Maybe an early bud, maybe starting to open, totally open, and then another one that looks like a puffball. Is it like a dandelion? Maybe we'll post a real picture of the creosote bush. Okay, now we have to get onto today's words. Top of page 295. The first word is crepe de Chine. So to add on, yesterday we had crepe, C-R-E-P-E. This one, the second word is D-E. Third word, C-H-I-N-E. Crepe de Chine. And you can put the little hat carrot accent on the first E in crepe if you want. This is a noun from 1869, and it is a soft, fine, or sheer clothing crepe, especially of silk. So let's see. If we go back to crepe, it's a light, crinkled fabric woven of any of various fibers, and this one is especially of silk. So why is it called crepe de Chine? Well, it is French, and it literally means China crepe. So this silk fabric, sheer fabric, is probably made and often used in China. So it's crepe de Chine. Okay, the sound effect. I just picked up some donuts this morning, Sunday morning, March 12, I think. I picked up some donuts from Beacon Donuts in this fine city of Chicago, and I ate one this morning. So my sound effect is just going to be donut. Okay, the next word is crepe myrtle. Second word is spelled M-Y-R-T-L-E. And again, if you want to put the accent in crepe, you can. Noun from 1916. The synonym is just crepe myrtle, where crepe is spelled C-R-A-P-E. And we can go quickly back to that. It is an Asian shrub. Okay. Donut? Next is crepe paper. Two words, noun from 1896. Paper with a crinkled or puckered texture. Maybe we should post a picture of crepe paper. Why? I don't know. Just because it's something to do? I feel like I don't really work with crepe paper. I probably have when I was a kid in like arts class or something. I feel like it's very thin is my memory. I could be wrong. But it's crinkly. Crinkly crepe paper. Donut. Next is crepe Suzette. Suzette is spelled S-U-Z-E-T-T-E. And the E in crepe, the first E, does have that hat carrot icon. Not icon, accent. Okay, noun from 1922. A thin folded or rolled pancake in a hot orange butter sauce that is sprinkled with a liqueur, like cognac or curacao, and it is set ablaze for serving. You gotta light it on fire. This sounds very interesting. Okay, why is it called Crepe Suzette? Well, it's probably from Suzette, which is the nickname of Suzanne Reichenberg, who was a French actress who died in 1924, and maybe this was just a favorite dish of hers. She said, you know what? I would like a thin folded or rolled pancake in a hot orange butter sauce that is sprinkled with a liqueur, probably cognac or curacao, and then please set it ablaze for serving to me. And somebody said, I shall call it a crepe Suzette. Sounds interesting. You're probably going to have to turn off the fire pretty quickly because you don't want it to get burnt. No burnt pancakes. Donut. Next is no more crepe words. This one is crepitant. Is it crepitant? Maybe it's crepitant. It is spelled how it sounds. Adjective from 1851. Having or making a crackling sound. This sounds medical. As in, crepitant sounds in breathing. Maybe you can also call a fireplace crepitant. The crepitant sounds of the fireplace. But if it's exclusively medical, then maybe not. Donut. Next is crepitate. Crepitate. This is an intransitive verb from circa 1828. To make a crackling sound. And the synonym is crackle. And crepitation is a noun. So, you know, this is leading me to believe that it's not strictly a medical thing. The etymology, Latin verb crepitare, which means to crackle, which is from crepare, which means to rattle or crack. Rattle and crack, crepare. That's it for crepitate. Next, donut. Next is crapon. Is it crapon? Crapon, but it's spelled C-R-E-P-O-N. I'm trying to figure out the, I'm misreading it. It is crepon. I thought the A over forget it. Crepon, noun from 1836, a heavy crepe fabric with lengthwise crinkles. So if it's a long fabric, it's longer than it is wise, then I guess the crinkles follow that long path. The crinkles are on the long ways. Yeah, it's just French for crepe. Okay, next. Donut. Next is crept, C-R-E-P-T. This is the past form of the word creep. Donut. Next is crepuscular. C-R-E-P-U-S-C-U-L-A-R. Crepuscular. Adjective from 1668. One of relating to or resembling twilight. Not the movie. The sky. And the synonym is dim, as in crepuscular light. This is a very good word to put in your writing or your poem or something. Number two, occurring or active during twilight, as in crepuscular insects, also as in crepuscular activity. Let's see. Well, okay, there's no etymology, which is very frustrating. But the next word is related, and there is some etymology there, so we'll learn more about it there. Because I was like, well, it's such a specific word for twilight that it seems like there needs to be more information. It's not like somebody made up the word crepuscular to mean twilight. Okay. Donut. I want the donut in my mouth. Okay, next is crepuscle. Let's see, crepuscle or crepuscule. Crepuscule. Noun from the 14th century, and the synonym is just twilight. I think those movies should be renamed crepuscule. Okay, this is from the Latin verb crepere. Is that how you would say it? C-R-E-P-E-R. All you Latin nerds, let me know. Crepere. And that just means dusky. You know, like dusk. Dusk and dawn, they're essentially the same thing, except opposites. Donut. Next is cresc. Although, I don't know how you'd say it in real life. It is spelled C-R-E-S-C, abbreviation for the word crescendo. I should say that word like crescendo. Hey, that's our next word, a donut. I already said it. Crescendo, first form, noun from 1775. 1A, a gradual increase, specifically a gradual increase in volume of a musical passage. Everybody who's played music with some sheet music has probably seen this, especially if you were in band or orchestra in school. You'll see either crescendo or C-R-E-S-C, or you might see how do I describe it? It's like two lines that are start from one point and then they go away. They spread out and go away. It means you're getting louder and louder and louder as this passage goes on. There is an opposite word to this, decrescendo, which we will get to in the D's, and I don't know yet when, what month or year that will happen. Okay, so number 1B for crescendo, the peak of a gradual increase, and the synonym is climax, so it is the crescendo of the crescendo, as in complaints about stifling smog conditions reach a crescendo. They have gone as far as they could, and then they will stop. That is a quote from Downbeat. Is that a magazine, a publication of some kind, I would assume? I would think it would be music-related, but it could be more like, what's the beat on the street? Just a local paper, maybe. Two, a crescendo musical passage. Crescendo is also an intransitive verb. So this is Italian, from crescendo, which means increasing. It's a gerund of crescere, which means to grow or increase. And that is all for that. Donut. Second form of crescendo. This is an adverb or an adjective from 1807. And it means with an increase in volume. And yes, it is used as a direction in music. Please, play this with an increase in volume for two measures. Okay, how many different ways can Spencer say donut?
Donut!
Next is crescent. First form, noun from the 15th century, 1A. The moon at any stage between new moon and first quarter and between last quarter and the succeeding new moon, when less than half of the illuminated hemisphere is visible. We've all seen these crescent moons, I think. So the reason it is crescent is because the sun is on the, a full moon is when the sun is on the opposite side of the earth as the moon. So it's the sun is hitting the moon full face from where we can see it. But then when the sun is on more closer to the moon, that is when we just see just a crescent, just a portion of it lit up. It's still lighting up a whole side, but we only see a part of it lit up. Those are very, very cool moons. I like the tiniest little sliver crescent moon. Okay, 1B, the figure of the moon at such a stage defined by a convex and a concave edge. So I don't know which one would be considered convex and concave. Is it the left side? Is it the right side? Is it the before the first quarter or after the last quarter? But either way, you know, depending on how you look at it, one of them is convex, which means it bulges out, and then the other one is concave, which means it curves in. Number two, something shaped like a crescent. A crescent roll. Crescentic, that is an adjective. That moon is looking so crescentic tonight. I don't think anybody would say that. Okay, this is from, the Anglo-French verb, I don't know how to say it, apologies, crestre, C-R-E-S-T-R-E, crestre, and that means to grow or increase. So that's interesting because we can see that this is related to crescendo etymologically. I never thought about what does this word mean. In the context of the moon. Well, see, that's not entirely true, but I don't know. It could be different things. It could be that means, you know, it's going to grow into a full moon. But also, you can think about by the fact that the ends are very tiny and they're like points, and then as it goes towards the center, it grows, it increases in size. The center of a crescent is always a little bit thicker than the edges, you know, the ends. Interesting. And then we have more from the Latin verb crescere, which is akin to the Old High German hirsi, which means millet. Also from the Lithuanian serti, which means to feed. From the Greek word koros, which means boy. And boy howdy, none of that makes any sense to me. It feels like somebody just threw all this stuff together. Millet, to feed. I mean, those are related, right? Because millet's a food. But then boy? This is very confusing. That's crescent for you. One of the most confusing words in the English language. Donut. Second form of crescent, adjective from 1574, marked by an increase. And the synonym is increasing, as in the example. It's a quote. My powers are crescent. That's from Shakespeare. I'm not sure where. Shakespeare. Maybe I'll put it in the show notes if I can find out which play that was from. So crescent, it basically means increasing. How exactly that became, you know, we visualize it as a moon or a crescent roll or something, I have no idea. Donut. Next is crescent again. This time we have a capital C at the beginning. This is a trademark, and it is used for an adjustable open-end wrench. Yeah, a crescent wrench. Do you want a picture of a crescent wrench on social media? Okay, you shall have it. All right, we got one more for this episode. Donut! How do you spell donut? Oh, we're going to have to get an expert on for the donut episode. Here's the thing. You can spell it D-O-N-U-T, or you can spell it D-O-U-G-H, N-U-T. But what's proper? Which one do we prefer? This book, it's dough. You know, it's made out of dough. So that's the proper term, D-O-U-G-H. But it does say that you can also spell it D-O-N-U-T. So if anybody gives you problems one way or the other, you can say the dictionary, Spencer told me I can spell it whatever way I want. You can even change it up even further if you prefer. But man, yeah, we're going to have to, what are we going to do for that episode? That's going to be a good one. Ooh, doughy. All right. So we read all the words, didn't we? No. I didn't finish. I didn't do the last word. I just said donut and then got distracted by donuts. Okay, the last word is cressive. C-R-E-S-C-I-V-E. Adjective from 1566. Marked by gradual spontaneous development. And cressively is an adverb. Okay, so the words were crepe de chine, crepe myrtle, crepe paper, crepe Suzette, crepitant, crepitate, crepon, crepon, yeah, excuse me, crept, crepuscular, crepuscle, cresc, crescendo, crescendo, crescent, 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 and cressive. Well, there's some pretty good stuff here. Crescendo, maybe I'll do crescendo because I can just do a very, very simple song and say crescendo. I don't want to get too loud and be irritating to everybody. Okay, that is it. Let's see. Since sometimes I talk about what I have watched, what did we watch recently? Watched a few things. We just watched, because I'm recording this before the Oscars. One of the theaters near us has the shorts that are nominated. So we watched the live action shorts, which are very good. And I watched yesterday the animated shorts, which are also very good. Some weird stuff in there, but it's good. If you can find them, go watch them. What else we watched? Oh, we finally got around to watching West Side Story, which is very well done. It's just a very classically good movie. Musicals are just weird. They're just weird, but it's fun and good. It is long, though, I warn you. But see, now I need to go rewatch the original because I'm not sure if I've even ever seen it, and I really want to do a comparison in my brain. That is all I have to say to you. Come join me tomorrow in the next episode when I talk about more words. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the dictionary. Hey, how are you doing? Thank you for turning on this podcast. Please go ahead and share it. You can tag me if you wanna. You should be able to do that. If you can't, let me know. We'll figure it out. Go let the people know. All right, so the first word in this episode is cresol. C-R-E-S-O-L. Don't know why that came out weird. Cresol. Noun from circa 1869. Any of three poisonous, colorless, crystalline, or liquid isomeric phenols. C7H8O. There are three of these poisonous, colorless, crystalline, or liquid isometric phenols, and any of them are cresols. And this is basically, it's an irregular form of creosote. Let's see, the sound effect is going to be, yup. Next is cress, C-R-E-S-S, noun from before the 12th century, any of various crucifers with moderately pungent leaves, used especially in salads, as a watercress. And the scientific species name for watercress is Nasturtium officinale. Officinale. And then B, the synonym is garden cress. I'm not very familiar with the cresses. I didn't realize that the leaves were moderately pungent. What do they smell like? The etymology basically just says akin to Old High German Kressa with a K, which means cress. So it's just cress means cress. Yep. Next word is cresset. So we just added an E-T to the previous word. Is it a little leaf? One of the leaves of a cress? Probably not. Noun from the 14th century. An iron vessel or basket used for holding an illuminant and mounted as a torch or suspended as a lantern. The example of the illuminant could be oil. You could light some oil on fire and then it will illuminate. So, yeah, let's see. The etymology. It is from Anglo-French, cris, which means grease. You could also probably light grease on fire. And there's more at the word grease. Go grease lightning, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Let's see. Yeah, it's just an iron vessel or basket holding a thing that can be lit on to be a torch and suspended in a lantern. I don't think people use these so much anymore, but maybe we'll find a picture. This seems like an old thing when there was no electricity to create light. Cresset. Yup. Next word, Cressida. Capital C-R-E-S-S-I-D-A. Noun from the 14th century. I think, anyway. A Trojan woman of medieval legend who pledges herself to Troilus, but while a captive of the Greeks, gives herself to Diomedes. So she's Trojan, she becomes a captive of the Greeks, and but she wanted to pledge herself, she tried to pledge herself to Troilus. I don't know who any of these people are. What did she do? She was just a legend? She was just a woman. She wasn't a goddess. She didn't have powers. She was just somebody. Okay. I'm very confused, I guess. There is a car. I had one of these because it was a used 3 times car called the Cressida. Was it Toyota? I think it was Toyota. I'm not entirely sure why they named a car after this Trojan woman, but it sounds like, I mean, she was a legend. Maybe we need to, we'll post a Wikipedia link in the show notes so we can go learn more about Cressida. But yeah, there's more to the story. It's good to get a little bit of information here, but yeah, what's the rest of the story? Okay, and I think somebody named Jessica should have a car called Cressida. Man, when I got the car, I think my dad bought it used, and then my sister had it, and then I got it, and it was 20 years old, and I wasn't taking great care of it, and the side mirror was broken, and it had a bunch of bumper stickers on it, and it was this poop brown color, but it did have a very cool, like a computer, like one of the early car computers. It was like a 1982 car, and it had this cool computer. It would tell you your miles per gallon and had a little, like a number pad. I just remember playing with that when I was a kid. Okay, next word. Yep. It is the word crest. First form, noun from the 14th century. 1A, a showy tuft or process on the head of an animal and especially a bird. And then it says to see the bird illustration. Yeah, it's the stuff on the top. It's their hair. It's, you know, the hair that pokes out of their head is the crest. 1B, the plume or identifying emblem worn on a knight's helmet. And then also the top of a helmet, like the crest of a bird. 1C1, a heraldic representation of the crest. What did I say for that one? It was 1C1. I feel like I said 1B1. Next is 1C2, a heraldic device depicted above the escutcheon, but not upon a helmet. A heraldic device depicted above the escutcheon, but not upon a helmet. And escutcheon is escutcheon. Can't wait to get to that word. 1C3, it is just the 2A definition for the words coat of arms. 1D, a ridge or prominence on a part of an animal body. A ridge or prominence. So anything that sort of sticks out or something. Maybe their back could be a crest, the top of their head. Those are the only things I can really think of. Depends on the animal. Number 2, something suggesting a crest, especially in being an upper prominence, edge, or limit. As 2A, the synonym is peak, P-E-A-K, like the peak of a mountain. Especially the top line of a mountain or hill. 2B, the ridge of a roof. That is the crest where the two parts meet at the top. 2C, the top of a wave. It crests over and then you can surf it or body surf it or boogie board it or just have it smash on you. Number 3A, a high point of an action or process, and especially of one that is rhythmic. So is that like the crest of a, well, this is getting into crescendo. That's probably what it's related to. Because yeah, the top of the rhythmic, the high point of like a rhythmic phrase is the crest where it peaks. Yeah, it crescendos to that point. 3B, the synonyms are climax and culmination, as in, at the crest of his fame. He hit the top of it, and it's just all downhill from there. Crestal, with an A-L, that is an adjective, and crestless is also an adjective. No crests for you. Let's see. From the Latin crista, which is probably akin to the Latin crinus, which means hair. Well, that makes sense with the bird, but it's so interesting that it also seems very related to crescent and crescendo because it's, you know, it's, I don't know, I just feel like that's the case, but it's not saying it is here. I suspect it is. Yep. Next is the second form of crest, verb from the 15th century, starting with transitive. 1, to furnish with a crest, also the synonym crown. 2, to reach the crest of, as in crested the hill and looked around, and they saw such beautiful sights. Now we have intransitive, to rise to a crest, as in, waves cresting in the storm. Cresting in the storm. Yep. Next is crested, adjective from the 14th century, and it just means having a crest, as in, a crested bird. Are there bird names? It's like the crested warbler, or the crested something or other. I feel like some of them have that name. It just means they have a crest, probably on the top of their head. Next, crested wheatgrass. 2 words, noun from 1923. Either of 2 Eurasian grasses that are grown in the U.S. for forage and for erosion control. Helps to stop the erosion. Well, these are very helpful then. Let's see, the names of these Eurasian grasses, Agropyron cristatum, and then also Agropyron desertorum, but then there's another one, Agropyron sibiricum. Yeah, maybe the first two are the same with different names, and then I don't know. Crested wheatgrass. Yep. Next is crestfallen, adjective from 1589. 1, having a drooping crest or hanging head. My head is hanging, so the crest on my head has fallen. Number two, feeling shame or humiliation. And the synonym is dejected. When you're not sharing this podcast, I feel so crestfallen. No, I'm kidding. I don't know when you don't do it. Crestfallenly is an adverb, and crestfallenness is a noun. Nobody wants to feel crestfallen. Next. Yep. Cresting. Noun from 1862. A decorative edging or railing, as on pottery or furniture. A decorative edging or railing. So, yeah, let's see. Maybe we'll find a picture of some interesting-looking cresting. Yeah, on the edge of a bowl, there might be some fancy edge. Or, let's see, a bookshelf or a dresser. Maybe on the edges, they've added some fancy, fancy cresting. Yep. Next is Cretaceous. This looks like one long definition. So, it is spelled capital C-R-E-T-A-C-E-O-U-S. I feel like the movie Cretaceous Park doesn't quite have the same ring as Jurassic Park. It's also maybe a little bit harder for people to say Cretaceous. Ooh, I should do, I'm maybe taking a pause on these backwards videos that I've talked about. I've got them on YouTube, but I think it would be fun to do all these old time periods, Jurassic, Cretaceous, the other ones that I can't think of at the moment, but there's a bunch of them. Paleontology? No, that's something else. Okay, Cretaceous, adjective from 1832. The time period was, though, way before 1832. Of relating to or being the last period of the Mesozoic era, characterized by continued dominance of reptiles, emergent dominance of angiosperms, diversification of mammals, and the extinction of many types of organisms at the close of the period. Also, of relating to or being the corresponding system of rocks. And then it says to see the geologic timetable. That'll be fun. Cretaceous is also a noun. All right, so I'm just gonna add a little bit more to this. Let's see, the corresponding system of rocks. This was the last section I read. You know, it's the time period when all those animals and living things lived, but then also all the rocks, when they go back, when they look at like a cliff or they go digging for rocks or something, they can see, you know, when those rocks were put there or when they were, I don't know. You know, there's a time period of that stuff. Okay, so what about all these animals and things? Okay, reptiles dominated. I'm assuming these are dinosaurs. This is the thing that I think a lot of people don't think about, is that dinosaurs, it's not like they all lived at the same time. There was one stage where certain dinosaurs lived, and then, you know, that lasted for millions of years. Millions of years. And then they went extinct, and then other dinosaurs cropped up, and they were around for millions of years. But, you know, it was maybe not so much extinct. Maybe it was more of an evolution. Not sure of the details. But basically, there were a certain amount of dinosaurs who dominated the Cretaceous period. The angiosperms, they were emerging. Mammals during this period diversified. It was probably a lot of very small mammals, but then because this was millions of years, they evolved and changed. They diversified their portfolio. And then there was lots of extinctions. Many types of organisms at the end of the Cretaceous, they went extinct. And they said, bye-bye. Okay. Yeah. Next word is cretin. C-R-E-T-I-N. Noun from 1779. Number one is often offensive. So don't use it. One afflicted with cretinism. And we're going to learn about that in the next one, but I'm pretty sure that that is a term that we do not use anymore. Okay, number two. Again, I would probably say maybe often offensive, but maybe this is slightly different context or very different context. It is a stupid, vulgar, or insensitive person. And the synonym is clod or lout. So, you know, they're just being a butthead, basically. So you can call them a cretin. They're acting stupid or vulgar or insensitive. They're not nice. Cretinous, with an O-U-S. That is an adjective. Let's see. This is from French. Cretin. It literally means wretch or innocent victim. Wretch is spelled with a W at the beginning. It's also somehow from the Latin Christianus, which means Christian. So I'm not sure how Christian and innocent victim or wretch are connected exactly, but I'm sure there's some logical reason for that. Okay. Yep. Next is this word that was just brought up, cretinism. Cretinism. Noun from 1801. I feel like I should probably find out when maybe we stopped using this, because this really should not be used anymore. So I have to preface this then with apologies in advance for what I'm about to read, because this is all very old school. A usually congenital abnormal condition marked by physical stunting and mental retardation and caused by severe hypothyroidism. So I think, you know, this probably is still a thing, but I have to believe that we have a different term for it these days. This all sounds very scientific, actually. There must be different medical terms for this than cretinism, which I don't think is the best one. Okay, we have one more word for this episode. Yep, we do. It is creton or creton, C-R-E-T-O-N-N-E, noun from 1863. It is a strong cotton or linen cloth used especially for curtains and upholstery. And this is from, I don't know how to say it, Creton, Normandy. Wait, is that, Normandy, is that a town in France or a city? And then is Creton a part of that town? Or maybe Normandy is the region, and then Creton, that is a town. And that's probably where they made this strong cotton or linen cloth. Okay, so the words in this episode were cresole, cress, cresset, cressida, crest, crest, crested, crested, wheatgrass, crestfallen, cresting, cretaceous, cretin, cretinism, and creton. Well, I really like Cretaceous. I just find all that stuff very fascinating. I should probably learn more about it. But we'll learn more in the geologic timetable. But I think, just from a personal standpoint, I'm going to pick Cressida as the word of the episode, because my very first car was a Cressida, and so I always have a very fond place in my heart for that word, I guess. I feel like I really should learn more about this Trojan woman of medieval legend. Cressida was a Trojan woman of medieval legend who pledges herself to Troilus, but while a captive of the Greeks gives herself to Diomedes. And there's probably more to the story. All right, I think that is enough for today. Thank you very much for listening. And until the next time, right after this one, this has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the podcast where this guy is reading the book and he tells you what he thinks about the things that he's reading in this book. It's a little ditty about the dictionary. Come listen to this podcast called The Dictionary. Okay, so let's read the words in this episode. The first one, have fun spelling this. It is Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. You can spell it capital C-R-E-U-T-Z-F-E-L-D-T hyphen capital J-A-K-O-B. Second word is disease. And you can also take off the T in Creutzfeldt if you want. What is it? It is a noun from 1963. A rare, progressive, fatal encephalopathy. I know how to say it. I don't know if it's coming out right. A rare, progressive, fatal encephalopathy caused by a prion and marked by development of porous brain tissue, premature dementia in middle age, and gradual loss of muscular coordination. Wow. Let's see. So it's rare. It is fatal. It's a thing that my mouth won't say. Caused by a prion, P-R-I-O-N, not sure what that is. And you can, there's porous brain tissue. How can they tell if it's porous or not? Premature dementia in middle age, so that would be a symptom. Because usually dementia happens in old age. And then also gradual loss of muscular coordination. This sounds pretty terrible. It is from Hans G. Creutzfeldt, who was a German psychiatrist who died in 1964. And then also Alfons M. Jakob, who was also a German psychiatrist who died in 1931. So they must have been the ones who got to name this thing, this condition, this disease. Didn't have a name before that. So they must have named it before this guy died. Well, it says 1963. I'm not sure the timing on that. Anyway, they got to name it, and it sounds pretty terrible. That's all I know about that. Maybe we can put a Wikipedia link or something to get more information. Maybe there's a whole website devoted to this disease. Sound effect. It's going to be... It's not supposed to be a cat purring. No, that's even more cat purring. I don't know what it is. It's something. Okay, the next word is crevalle. C-R-E-V-A-L-L-E. Noun from 1879. Any of several carangid fishes. Especially the synonym Jack crevalle. Or is it crevalle? Maybe it's crevalle. And then the genus name is Caranx. C-A-R-A-N-X. Caranx. It just says it's an alternative of cavalla. Next word is crevasse. C-R-E-V-A-S-S-E. Noun from 1813. One, a breach in a levee. That would be the thing that they got to help with floods. If a city like New Orleans is below sea level, they have to have levees around to keep the water out. So when it breaches, you sometimes call that a crevasse. Number two, though, I think is the one that we think of more so. A deep crevice or fissure, as in a glacier or the earth. So yeah, in a glacier that could be just a giant, like a canyon, like a crevice, you call it a crevasse. Also just in the earth, in the rock, there could be a crevasse. See, I was kind of going for like a helicopter sound, but no, that's more like a... No. This is not working. Okay, next word. Crevice. we got crevasse, and then we got crevice. They're right next to each other. Noun from the 14th century, a narrow opening resulting from a split or crack, as in a cliff. And the synonym is fissure. This is from Anglo-French, crevere, which means to break. Also from Latin, crepare, which means to crack. So if a thing has broken or cracked, it has a fissure in it, you can call that it's a crevice. It's a crevice. All right, brain and mouth, work together this time. No. This is the worst. Okay. We're just going to do that. Next word. It is the word crew. C-R-E-W. First form. This is the chiefly British past form of crow. So you mean like a crow? When they make their sound, they crow? The past form is crew? That crow crewed. Okay. Next word is the second form of crew. Noun from the 15th century. Number one is archaic. A band or force of armed men. Or just armed people. 2A. A group of people associated together in a common activity or by common traits or interests. 2B. The synonym is the 1B2 definition for the word gang. It's a gang of people, a crew of people. 3A. A company of people working on one job or under one foreman or operating a machine. So lots of possibilities there. They got one job, or they're under one foreman, or they're all operating a machine. Like a crew of people fixing a street. 3B, the whole company belonging to a ship, sometimes including the officers and master. And then also, one who assists the skipper of a sailboat. Yeah, I feel like I've heard when people are going to go sailing, let's go crew the boat, be the crew, do that thing. 3C, the persons who have duties on an aircraft in flight. They are the flight crew. Thank you, flight crew people, for serving us, first of all. Thank you for drinks and food, taking care of us, bringing us pillows and blankets, and keeping us safe. 3D, the rowers and coxswain of a racing shell. Also just the synonym rowing. I think usually you hear rowing crew, but I guess you could also just say rowing. Crewless is an adjective. When there's no crew on a plane, how does it go anywhere? There's no pilot. There's no people serving mimosas. That plane is crewless. This is from Middle English crew, also from Middle French. It means reinforcement. Also just literally means increase. So if you're increasing, like number one, the archaic one, it is a band or force of armed men. They are the reinforcements. But if you are increasing the reinforcements, that's more literally what it means. Let's see. Also from Anglo-French verb cloistre. Oh, didn't we have that yesterday somewhere? I think we did. Cloistre, which means to grow. I think maybe we had that for crescent or something. Here, from Latin, crescere, and there's more at the word crescent. Crescent and crew, related etymologically. They're, what would you call that? Are they siblings? Are they cousins? Depends on how deep you want to go. Next word, third form of crew, verb, from 1935. To act as a member of a crew. That was intransitive. And the transitive says, to serve as a crew member on. On what? A ship or an aircraft? See, I'm doing a very quick flutter of the tongue, but I want to do something slower. No, that's not it. Nope, we're just not going to worry about it. Next is crew chief. Two words, noun from 1926. One who is in charge of a crew of workers, especially a non-commissioned officer, as in the Air Force, who supervises an airplane's ground crew. They need to be managed, so the crew chief does that. Next word is crew cut. Two words, noun from 1942. A very short haircut, usually for men or boys, in which the hair resembles the bristle surface of a brush. What? It resembles the bristle surface of a brush. So why is it called a crew cut? Is it because all the people get the crew cut because they're part of a crew? They all have the same haircut. It's the cut of the crew. Is that it? Or is the brush a thing that the crew uses to clean things, like clean the poop deck on a sailboat? So that it's the cut. Is that what it is? It doesn't say. There's no etymology. Another name for this is buzz cut. I went and looked back, and the synonym for buzz cut just took us here to crew cut. I always used the phrase buzz cut when I was a kid because I had one. I had a buzz cut for years. Let's see. Probably, I'm trying to think of how old I was when I first got it. Maybe fifth grade, fourth grade, up until maybe sixth grade. Wait, no. Had to have been longer than that. Was it? I don't know. I did go back to it, actually, after probably after senior year of high school. I went back to a buzz cut, and I had that for quite a while. I did it myself, actually, for most of those years. I got some clippers, just would buzz it in my bathroom every month, and saved a bunch of money. Okay. Next word is cruel. It's not the mean cruel. It is C-R-E-W-E-L. Noun from the 15th century. One, slackly twisted worsted yarn used for embroidery. Lots of adjectives for that kind of yarn. Slackly and an adverb. Slackly twisted worsted. That's fun. Cruel. Number two, the synonym is cruel work, which is all one word. Fancy that. It is our next word, cruel work, noun from 1863. Embroidery work with cruel. Embroidery, which one is that? Is that when you embroider something? See, that's a silly joke. If you're using this slackly twisted worsted yarn for embroidery and you're working it with it, you're doing cruel work. It's very cruel. Cruel and unusual work. Next is crewman. Now, we're not going to see crewwoman, so, you know, you can just assume that this is for both all, you know, all genders, non-gender, doesn't matter. Crewman, noun from circa 1927, a member of a crew. Crew person is probably better. Okay. Next is crewmate. Noun from 1938. That doesn't usually happen. Crewmate 1938. Just a fellow crewman is a crewmate. Like your friend, your buddy, your peer, your pal. We're crew people together, mate. Okay. Next is crew neck. Two words, noun from 1939. One, a round collarless neckline. Is that what I'm wearing right now? I think so. Most of my t-shirts are crew neck, I guess. Number two, this one is usually one word. It is a sweater with a crew neck. It would just be a round collarless neckline. This is from the sweaters with this neckline worn by oarsmen. Those are the people who were working the oars of a boat. And so I guess they typically would wear sweaters that have this neckline. I just, for some reason, think it's so funny that the neckline got its name because of the thing that they were wearing that already existed, only because they just wore it in that situation of being a crew member. Did it have a different name before that? Was it just round neck? I don't know. It's just a funny context to me. Next is crew sock. Two words, noun from 1948. Are these the socks that the crew people wear? It is a short, bulky, usually ribbed sock. And it doesn't say where it comes from, why it's called crew sock. So we'll never know. All right, one more word. I guess that was a little bit more what I was going for. It is the first form of the word crib. This is our last one if I didn't say it. C-R-I-B. Noun from before the 12th century. One, a manger. I know it. A manger for feeding animals. Two, an enclosure, especially of framework, as 2A, a stall for a stabled animal. 2B, a small child's bedstead with high enclosing, usually slatted sides. Would that just be, yeah, it's a crib. That's what it is. It's a small child's bedstead. Why does it have to say bedstead? Why can't it say bed? I don't know. But yes, high enclosing, usually slatted sides, so they can't climb out or sneak through. You want to make sure those slatted sides are relatively close together so they can't squeeze anything out, like their head or arm, and get stuck. 2C, any of various devices resembling a crate or framework in structure. 2D, a building for storage. And the synonym is the word bin. Go put the things in that bin. I also want to say crib. No, I don't call those things cribs, just bins. 3A, a small narrow room or dwelling. And the synonyms are hut and shack. A small narrow room. Narrow room. 3B, a room or shack used for prostitution. Didn't see that coming. Interesting. Wonder what, like, where, just any old room or shack? Why do they call it a crib? Maybe we'll look at the etymology and see if it helps. 4. The cards discarded in cribbage for the dealer to use in scoring. And this must be, it's cribbage, just probably got shortened to crib, I guess. It's not like the discard pile. It's just called the crib. 4A, a small theft is called a crib. 5B, the synonym is plagiarism. Oh, is that why they call it a crib sheet? Because you use it to, well, sometimes it's allowed, but you use it to cheat from? A small theft, a plagiarism, okay. 5A, a literal translation, especially the number 3 definition for the word pony. Now, I need more context. Can't wait to get to pony to learn about that. A literal translation, a crib. 5D, a summary and key to understanding a literary work. I don't know about that one either. But all you writers, you probably know. 5E, something used, oh, here it is, something used for cheating in an examination. Yeah, crib sheet. I don't think that was something that people of my age used. I think I heard it from older people, like my parents. I feel like that's more of a, from their generation, they would say crib sheet. Every once in a while, I guess people of my age probably say it. And then the last one, number six, it is the number one definition for the word. Let's see if I can find out how to pronounce it. Is it creche? I think it's creche. Yes, creche or creche, spelled C-R-E-C-H-E with an accent on the first E. Okay, the etymology for crib. Old English crib with two B's, akin to the Old High German krippa, which is manger, and perhaps to the Greek word griffos, which means reed basket. So all of those things make me think of just a crib for a baby. So it's not been very helpful for, you know, a hut, a shack, a room, cribbage, cheating, all that stuff. It's not helpful. It's just the English language evolving in ways that you can't predict, and maybe sometimes you can't figure out how or why it happened. Okay, the words in this episode were Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, crevalli, crevasse, crevice, crew, crew chief, crew cut, cruel, cruel work, crewman, crewmate, crew neck, crew sock, and crib. Well, I don't remember if I picked buzz cut for that episode, but I think I'm just going to go ahead and pick crew cut as the word of the episode because that is a haircut that I have had for many years of my life. So it's, you know, it's very important to me. I love the crew cut on my head because it was easy. I could just buzz it by myself and it was great and fuzzy like a brush. I should have charged people to just, you know, people like to run their hands across your freshly buzzed hair. And that was, people like that. I don't know. It felt like velvet. What is this, velvet? Okay, let's see. We recently watched the biopic about Aretha Franklin called Respect, starring Jennifer Hudson. She is pretty damn talented. And that's an understatement. So yeah, that was fun to watch. Learned a lot about Aretha Franklin. Not a kid's movie, but yeah, it's worth a watch. Anything else? I think I'm probably forgetting some other things that we've been watching, but there's so much. There's so much I can't keep track. I can't keep up with all of it. It's just, can you people just stop making things for like a year so I can get semi caught up? I'm still trying to watch things from before I was born. Jeez, that was like a whole 80 years of stuff. All right. That's going to be it for this episode. Thank you very much for listening to me yammer on. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye.